on behalf of HSM and make an equal donation to our school. Thank you, Union Rapids Dementia Center, a division of Rapids Regional Medical Center.
Yeah, we are live, and trying to get to the main camera. There we go. Folks, we are live at Holy Savior Menard Central High School for the homecoming game tonight, October 27th, a Friday night. And, man, it is late October, but it feels like September a little bit, minus about 20 degrees, maybe 30 of what it was this year. But it is a warm night. But it's not raining. We got a full moon, which means no chance of rain here on the field and over the stadium. This is a big night tonight as they'll crown the king and the queen for homecoming. Find out who won the homecoming floats. John Wolf is with me in the booth. We've got Andrew Beeman running camera right now and Jeffrey Owens waiting on Coach David Perkins to come out to do the pregame interview. And we'll have that soon. But waiting for him to call in and be able to catch Coach Perkins. We've got homecoming 50-year reunion, 1973 folks out there, a great crowd of those folks. And we've got the 40-year guys from 1983 that are present tonight, as well as the 30-year, the 20-year, and the 10-year folks. Lots of folks building up over there in the end zone on the left-hand side of the field. You're looking at the right-hand side of the field with the cheerleaders and dance line all lining the goalposts, waiting for the Menard Eagles to come out and run through. Here they come. Come walking out, carrying the American flag. And John, not only did I mention all of that, but amongst all of that, an even bigger scenario tonight is the district championship all by themselves, the first time in like 13 years that Menard has a chance to do that tonight.
Yeah, I mean, we got a football game tonight, right? Everything you said, and we're about to play some ball, and Menard's going for outright district championship, not having to split it, and see the Eagles come out and, you know, play a tough Oakdale team. And all right. I guess we're waiting on Jeffrey.
Well, he's going to wait. David wants to run out with the team, and I don't blame him with it being homecoming and big. But Jeffrey needs to go ahead and call me and get set up. Let me call him. Go ahead and talk, John.
Yeah, you know, just talking about Oakdale and kind of what they're going to be doing tonight. They got a couple playmakers. They've got some size, as we can see and seen on film. They do have some speed. You're going to see number 2, number 6, number 11 on the offensive side of the ball. They'll run in what you're going to think is an Ovoyles style offense with two double wing backs and something like the Veer. They'll run the triple option out of it.
That's just phone.
Yep. And you'll see a lot of triple option tonight. And don't throw it a whole lot, but they will try to throw it downfield every now and again, probably a little bit more than Rose Pine did.
That was me calling Jeffrey Owens. Jeffrey, I know you're listening, so just hang tight. I wanted to have the phone ready to go when David gets out there rather than trying to dial and make a connection whenever he catches up to you. So we'll keep an eye on it, and when he gets there, we're going to turn it over to you. You know, right now we're waiting for the team to come out, and I'm nervous, John.
Yeah.
I mean,
you know, that's
look,
all right.
But I got to tell you, I've been calling 9 years. I've been calling the Menard Eagles, and we have
I've been calling 9 games.
We have not been in this position the whole time I've been the voice of the Eagles.
So that brings it up. I mean, this is my first year. Somebody's going to double my pay, right?
Yeah, that's right. David was on call with me last
year.
We made the playoffs.
Yeah.
We just weren't playing for a district championship. Last year, we made it all the way to game 10. Glen Oaks had to win it to get in. Now we're sitting in the playoffs no matter what.
Yeah.
And there's a district championship no matter what. It's just a matter of sharing it or taking it off.
Well, Coach Perkins talked about it earlier this week, you know, at the pep rally, and he mentioned on the coach's show. I mean, how often does a team get the chance to play for a district championship at home during homecoming?
That's right.
Something that just doesn't get to happen.
Well, and if you can't get fired up for that, then you shouldn't be on the field. That's pretty much what Coach Perkins was saying. David's walking out now. Hopefully, Jeffrey, go meet him real quick. Run out there because we got to take a commercial break in just a second. So we're going to turn it over to Jeffrey. Coach Perkins, congratulations on the game tonight and having the opportunity to win district outright. What did you tell the guys right before they went out on the field?
Well, I told them that before the season, a lot of people gave them a chance to be in this situation and to go out and have fun tonight. They play football because they want to have fun. They've got a chance to do what none of our guys have a chance to do in a while for 13 years. They've got a chance to win a district championship. They've got one chance to do it, and we got to make it right tonight.
Look, all I know is I'm nervous for you guys, and I'm not even playing. I'm just calling the game. You know, you got to be nervous. The guys got to be nervous. How do you handle that?
Well, they're nervous, but I think after a couple of plays, everything will go back to normal, and everybody will be able to do what they need to do. And, hey, man, we just need to get this dub.
And one quick question by Jeffrey, and then say what you say at the end of everything.
So how is practice going this week with all the homecoming events going on?
Great practice all week long. It's not hard to get up for something for a district championship, so we're ready to play, baby.
All right.
Go Eagles.
Then we'll take a break for the prayer and the national anthem right after.
Those who have traveled here to be and support our team, support our school, we ask that you please be with all of our players, all of our coaches, all of our fans. We may have a safe and fun night tonight. We ask all this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our
our very own Mr. Tom Boucher on the national anthem. All right, we're going to go to break real quick. We'll see y'all in a few.
Wherever you are, you're there for a reason. You shouldn't have to make a trip to the branch to deposit a check. Skip the trip and use our mobile app to easily and securely deposit checks right from your phone. Day or night, wherever you are, or whatever you're doing. Download our mobile app today.
Is your vision just not as crisp and clear as it used to be? Are you having difficulty driving, especially at night? Are you over 40 and now needing reading glasses? If so, the trusted eye care team at Wallace Eye Associates is here to help with your family's eye care needs, just like we have been for nearly 40 years. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
And we're back live in Alexandria, Louisiana, home of the Holy Savior Menard Central High School Eagles. One of the last two games of the year that the Eagles will get to host. And the snap, or coin toss just occurred out in the center of the field. And the Eagles have won the toss, and they elect to defer to the second half. And so they will give the ball to Oakdale. And why not? When this defense... This defense has been lights out all year long. Even in our losses, they played most of the time, well enough for the to win, while the offense was trying to figure out how to put more points on the board. 5-3 on the year as we start tonight. But the most important record is 3-0 in district, and with a win tonight, they will go undefeated in district for the first time in a long time. They will be outright district champs for the first time in 13 years. And Oakdale stands in the way because they have a 6-2 record. They are 1-1 in the district. They still have another game after this one, and hopefully we'll send them to that next game 1-2 on the year while we are 4-0. As we get set for kickoff, Matthew Hicks will kick it off. He was one of our captains tonight, along with Cody Lyons.
Ryan Hicks. His brother.
His brother, Matt, is the long snapper. Thank you, John. Ryan Hicks. I knew that. Number four, Maddox Shelton was a captain in 81. Drake Aldridge, a captain. John, you were talking about it in the pregame. The why not stop keys to the game tonight for Menard.
Yeah, I think on the offensive side of the ball, you take this defense, they're going to be pushing upfield. Defensive ends are really rushing upfield. They play a little bit of undisciplined ball. Menard's going to have to take advantage of that. On the defensive side of the ball, we got to contain, keep the running backs from getting outside.
So here's the kick, and it is a line drive hauled in at the 2-yard line up to the 15-20. He's got a hole. And Ryan Hicks is there to help take him down. He had the initial hit brought down at about the 35-yard line. So good field position for Oakdale as Ryan unable to get it into the end zone. Almost caught a break there with him sliding at the 1-yard line. Yeah. The knee almost touching the ground.
Well, you see a little bit of the speed Oakdale brings. I mean, they do have team speed, and they've got some size on them. So it's not going to be a pushover for Menard tonight. They are going to have to play good assignment football.
Why not stop keys to the game? I know you saw the graphic already. No worries on that, Andrew. But as John kind of talked about, we're going to clog that middle. We got to keep it clogged, but then we have to contain the outside on this, triple wing trying to fool you. There's the pitch, and out to the outside. Carson Harrison is right there, and that is played perfectly by the defense as Drake Aldridge gets him. But credit Cody, Carson Harrison for holding the edge.
Yeah, Carson came up, right cornerback spot, came up, saw him coming, kept it contained and gave Drake the opportunity to make the tackle from the inside out. And that's what you look for on a play like that.
Loss of two. We want to give quick thanks to our sponsors, especially our annual sponsors. Want to thank Carolyn Markintel for the thank you that she texted in. My son Chase watching tonight, all the way up in New York City tonight. Stay safe up there, Chase. And here's a fake handoff up the middle, taken to the outside, and there's that speed you were talking about. He broke it. He's going to go all the way for the touchdown from the 32-yard line. 68-yard run by the quarterback as he got to the edge, and that was our why not stop key to the game, is you cannot let him get to the edge.
That was number 11.
11.
Yeah, Dakota Johnson, quarterback. You know, that they're playmakers. They got three of them, 2, 6, and 11. And we saw it, and when they get outside, they're going to try to get those guys outside because they know they have the advantage on speed.
So it's big, big run, and Oakdale opening up on their first drive, second play of the drive, and that fake handoff up the middle kind of sucked everybody in, and we lost the edge. They tested it to the near side of the field as they were moving right to left. They'll go for two up the middle, and they're going to stuff that. And hopefully we can do that all night long, and we'll need it. 6-0 the score with 10:53 left in the first quarter. We're back right after these messages.
BK Distributors is proud to support high school athletics on 446 Sports. BK is the one-stop shop for trophies, banners, awards, letter jackets, and just about anything award-related. And now, welcome BK Apparel and BK Promotions to the family. For all your Spirit Apparel needs and anything you need to brand your business, when you think of anything you need with your name on it, think BK. Check them out on Facebook or at bkdistrib.com. BK Distributors, apparel and promotions in Pineville.
Time for a red, white, and cool summer event at Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing. Right now, you can save on a new energy-saving system. No money down, 0% interest, and no payments till June 2024. Call Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing or visit us online.
And we're back live in Alexandria, Louisiana. The Eagles nest, and the Eagles, not the way they wanted to start. They put the defense out there for a reason, and that was to set the tone. And unfortunately, they were tone deaf on that first drive, and they let them get to the outside. Here's the kick. It'll be the offensive turn to after Maddox Shelton returns it. He's got a nice return here to the 40, out to the 45, and taken down at the 45-yard line. And that's a great return for Maddox. And the Eagles offense has got to answer the Warriors' score, and that way the defense can come back and do another resetting of the tone.
Yeah, good job by Maddox there picking that ball up. Oakdale, you know, on their kickoffs, we're going to see a lot of kickoffs like that. That's not a mistake by Oakdale. That's kind of what they do. And a good job by Maddox pick that ball up and pick up 20, 25 yards on the return right there.
Just trying to get an update sent in. Haven't really had to – well, we have had to send an update that early. It's just been a better one.
That was on week one we had to do that.
6-0. 10:46 to play in the game. They pitch it out to Aiden Moran, and they've got that outside sealed as he came to the near side of the field. He's knocked out of bounds. About a 2-yard loss. It'll set up a second down and 12 as the Eagles are moving left to right on their first drive. 6-0, Oakdale.
Yeah, Eden trying to get out there on the right side. We had some defensive line penetration. Linebackers flowed over really well on that and cut it off on the short side of the field.
You can see the score at the top of the screen, 6-0. Want to thank Wallace Eye Center for being our sponsor the last several years. Here's the Eagles faking the handoff. He's got pressure. Pass is wide open. What a great catch.
Excellent.
By Aiden Moran. Well, no, that was Gavin Hilton, number 12.
Yeah, Gavin. No, that wasn't Gavin. Who was that? That was
– It was 12.
Was it 12? No, it was 17. Who's 17?
That's not Wyatt. Is there a 17 out there right now?
Matthew Hicks.
Oh, Matthew Hicks.
I think that was Matthew that made that snag. Ball was thrown behind him and okay. Good adjustment.
Man, did he have to flip around and make the catch. That was great hands. Wallace Eye Associates, they have been our school board sponsor over the last couple of years, an annual sponsor. I want to thank them. Here's the handoff to Aiden Moran going left side, and he's going to be stacked up. Man, oh, man, this defense looks more like what Menard has played. They're ready. The Eagles are going to have to kind of, you know, loosen up a little bit and get things rolling and start you know, gaining control at the line of scrimmage.
Look, you know, they're an athletic team. They're going to be a lot more athletic than we faced against Rose Pine. Going to be very similar to a Vols, but they'll play upfield. They're going to try to get into the backfield and wreak havoc.
Defense definitely going to need a stop on this one, but key here, they got two folks back, number five, and can't see the number on the far side of the field, but hopefully Ryan can – hang it up there a little bit and let us get down there. We got to make a tackle for sure. And here's a punt. He shanked it. And that's going out of bounds way early. And they'll mark that somewhere around the 40, maybe 35-yard line. 38?
Yeah, 38 looks like.
About the Oakdale 38. That's 3 yards better than the kickoff return that they got on the opening kickoff. The Eagles got to collect themselves here on defense and get back to the scheme that they had practiced all week long. And Coach Scully has had them all ready to play every game. They just got to settle in. Want to thank Sadler's Towing for the ticker down at the bottom as the teams update their scores, all of those 4-4-6 teams that play. Tioga taking on Peabody tonight, a key district game there. And Ash has a big district game tonight against West Monroe. They're actually hosting, all teams hosting tonight. There's a play that went awry, and they're going to gain a couple of yards out to the 40, but the running back ran into Dakota Johnson, and both of them carried the ball for 2 yards.
Yeah, just kind of a scrum up the middle right there, and you know, that's kind of Menard's strong point on the defense, has been all year, the teeth, you know, and the tip of the spear right there, and that defensive line has done well so much this year.
Got to thank Valex Federal Credit Union.
We have a foul on here. They're actually calling a
false start.
Yeah, false start.
Going to set them back 5 yards, I guess, because it was a false start. Yeah. We can't do anything about it. But we'll take the first and 15 that the Oakdale will have coming up on this play. But Valex Federal Credit Union, see their title and their graphic down at the bottom right? They have been the title sponsor. I mean, the title sponsor of the show for the last 2 years for all of our shows, which are closing in on 300 broadcasts a year on 446 Sports. In fact, we did the junior high championship last night between Tioga and Pineville Junior High Schools at Pineville High. Here's Dakota Johnson rolling out, looking to throw, and we got pressure on him. Now, don't let him get back in and around. We got to chase him down. He's way back. Don't let him get to the outside. There's a block in the back. There's a pass. Let's intercept it. Set up for Carson Harrison in the air. Brought down by
I
think we got it, and we did. That is number 7, Jaden Williams. Got to talk to that young man during the coach's show at Wildwood Pizza, and we'll be able to decline that penalty, the block in the back, and take the interception. But Carson Harrison, no, Maddox Shelton coming up holding his wrist. Let's hope that that's not anything serious. We did lose Cody Lyons last week. He's out for the year. And that's why we're going to see Carson Harrison a lot. But Carson did a nice job, just didn't make the catch. But
yeah,
that allowed Jaden to get the right tip ball.
Yeah, they threw it down. You know, the quarterback's mobile. Number 11's mobile. He can run. And Braylon Dusang was coming there backside, you know, trying to seal that edge off when he was running back all the way across. Got blindside blocked. And fortunately, you know, we got the interception on that. So we're going to decline that penalty, and we'll take it over here at the 35-yard line. But good job by Drake on the right edge, you know, keep that quarterback, get a little pressure on him, and
Menard
go awry.
Menard 35-yard line is where they will start. 8:16 to go in the first quarter. It is 6-0 Eagles. What a great job to come back by the defense. Here's the fake pitch up the middle is Jake Vaughn. He's going to pick up a couple, and we just need to get a first down and let the offense settle down a little bit. Get these nerves out that they have. I'm sure, you know, they've been hearing it all week. You know, if you can't get fired up for this one, you can't get fired up for this one, and it's district championship. So, you know, that builds up. I was feeling it before the game.
Yeah, I mean, it gets you out of your routine, right? And, you know, fortunately, this interception, big momentum change. So, you know, at this point, hey, we're playing a football game like we've done 8 weeks prior. Let's go out and play.
They overloaded four receivers on the near side of the field. Going in motion is Gavin Hilton going to throw the ball downfield, wide open, Matt Kirk. And it is overthrown. And
Matt came in, you know, kind of cut it off and was open there, and the defender overran it, and Gavin just threw it a little long on him. Kind of had to jump there, had a little pressure at the end, and just overthrew him just a little bit.
You know, I was going to say, kind of talked about it with Coach Scully and Coach Perkins at the coaches show, the Eagles Nest coaches show on Wednesday night at Wildwood. We do that live, by the way, at 7 o'clock. Come out and join us every Wednesday during football season. But we talked about it. Looking at the film, their defensive backs bite like crazy, or did at least in the film that I watched. You saw it yourself. And they kind of hung back right there. They stayed with the play. Let's see if we can get them burned. Jake didn't throw it, and he's going to be ran right into a sack, nice. But got out of it, rolling around, got a man open, overthrows, but caught, and he's down to Jordan. The 30-yard line. Jordan Rich with the over-the-shoulder catch, and how did Jake Vaughn get out of that? 64 had him wrapped up.
Hey, man, you know, we saw on film their QB making plays, and look at Jake right there and throwing it out over there to Jordan, and Jordan making a heck of a catch, man, over the shoulder. Looked like that ball was going to be overthrown. And
I was already calling it as overthrown. Man, great catch. There's a cool play of the game. Southern Air cool play of the game candidate right there. They don't have to be touchdowns. That was just a really nice play.
How many yards was that, Tom?
Well, it was from the 35 down to the 37-yard line, so we'll mark that one. That's 10, 20, 30, about 33 yards, 32 yards. Aiden Moran off the left side trying to cut the corner. Boy, nice job on the tackle coming up and wrapping him up. Going to gain it about out to the 20. Well, they're saying the 28, maybe only 1 yard on the gain. So it was down to the 32 at the 32-yard line. Excuse me. So we were down to the 33. So that's 10, 20, 30, 32 yards on that reception. 6:12 to go in the first quarter. Been an exciting game already. Oakdale scores on the second play of their first drive. And the Eagles go three and out, but they get an interception. And now with a huge play,
got a
Jake
little bit
Vaughn.
Of confusion. Yep. We got some confusion on offense. We're going to have to burn a timeout. And it looks like Aiden Moran kind of came running over.
Didn't know he was supposed to be in the game. We're going to take a timeout ourselves. We'll be back right after this. Eagles trail 6-0.
Buying car insurance for the first time can be overwhelming. Do you have enough coverage? Are you paying too much? Will someone be there for you when the unexpected happens? I'm Jason Hawk with Farm Bureau Insurance. You may think it's easier online, but why wait? We're here to help you make sure you're covered. When it comes to car insurance, we have the answers, and we may have rates that save you money. So talk to Hawk at 318-791-HAWK or online at talktohawk.com and let us help you protect your biggest investments.
And we're back live in Alexandria, Louisiana, the Eagles Nest, as the Menard Eagles are hosting the Oakdale Warriors in a big, big showdown tonight between two District 4 2A teams. Hand off to Aiden Moran down the right side, and he tried to cut it up, and they're tight in that middle right now, and it is up to the 30-yard line. It's going to set up a third down and about seven.
Yeah, just not much room to run there and in the middle, and it brings up another passing down for us.
Yeah, we're going to have to loosen this this defense up, and we haven't really had a hard time running up the middle in most of our games, so we'll have to figure out how to get that going. There's movement on the line. I'm surprised that wasn't throwing. Boy, they were back there to take the handoff. How did that happen?
Yeah,
three sacked Gavin Hilton back at the original line of scrimmage.
Yeah, just came around the edges and got penetration right there, and we knew they were going to be aggressive on that defensive front.
Wow, he was lucky to get the handoff to Gavin. It's a loss of about three. Third and 10, they got to get to the 22-yard line or 23-yard line.
Looks like we're going to go for it here.
Yeah, I was thinking they might pull –
may try to
you
draw
Ryan Hicks
and,
out
and pick up an extra five, and we may actually go for it. We'll just have to see.
You know, no direct snap. We got it. We got a little bit of a triple wing T type of thing going ourselves.
Wing ourselves.
Going to give it back to him. There's a pass down the sideline, and he just overthrew Jordan Rich. He was trying to throw a shoulder pass. Had Gavin Hilton open over the middle. But that's a fourth down, turnover on downs, and the Eagles defense will have to hold one more time as Oakdale has their worst field position, their own 32-yard line.
Yeah, just quite hadn't figured out that defensive front yet on Oakdale, and to run against it or keep that pressure off. We knew they were going to be aggressive up front.
33 yards of offense. Well, they went back to the 30. They went back to the 35. Oh, no, 32. Yep. That's right. 33 yards of offense for the Eagles. They have 38 on the for the first quarter here. 4:20 to play. Oakdale from their own 32 moving right to left. And they'll make man in motion coming near side. They give it to him right up the middle and breaking tackles. Maddox Shelton's going to have to catch him, and I don't know if he's going to be able to do it. Number four is in for the touchdown. That went right up the gut, and the speed is showing on this Oakdale team. Boy, he ran over Gavin. One of our linebackers.
Well, I think he may have ran over Gavin also.
That is a 68-yard Wow, 68-yard touchdown run. That's the second one of the night for Oakdale. 4:08 to play in the first quarter, and Oakdale leads it 12-0, and they will try to go for two. Really got to watch this. I saw this on their film, and the quarterback sometimes will take the snap and then just run it in himself. He did on that, and it was a good two-yard our two-point conversion. There's a pass, and it's incomplete. Running back wasn't even ready for it over there. So really interesting stuff. But a missed two-point conversion again, but they got two touchdowns, and they lead it 12-0 with 4:08 to go in the first quarter. We're back right after these messages.
For a lifetime of the best possible vision, look to Wallace Eye Associates, where our tradition of eye care excellence in Senlaw spans nearly 40 years. From your next family eye exam to cataract and glaucoma evaluations, trust your vision to the experienced eye professionals at Wallace Eye Associates. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
Time for our Red, White, and Cool summer event at Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing. Right now, you can save on a new energy-saving system. No money down, 0% interest, and no payments till June 2024. Call Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing, or visit us online.
And we're back live with 4:08 to go in the first quarter. And 12-0 Eagles, as Oakdale has jumped out on top. Twelve nothing, and the Eagles with the kickoff coming. Matt Ritchie coming up here at the game. And here's a onside kick hauled in by Carson Harrison, and a great job to take it in and lay down as they have the hands team up there. Great job by Coach Perkins to be ready on the onside kick.
Yeah, good job by Carson right there. You never know what you're going to get, ball bouncing at you, coming in the air, a pooch kick or what, and have to be able to hustle on it like that. Good play.
Great field position right at midfield with 4:08 to play. Thank my wife Cindy watching tonight. You know, that's one thing we haven't had a whole lot of this year is folks texting me, letting me know that they're tuning in and watching. I got to say thanks, Gage Oser's grandmother, sitting there proud with the 63 on the back of the jersey. She's down here at the game coming up from Covington. Here's a handoff to Aiden Moran, and he broke a tackle himself and picked up five. And they're only going to give him four on that out to the 46-yard line of Oakdale.
Good blocking by the offensive line to hold their blocks and keep those guys held up and giving Aiden a chance to get that ball through there.
Speaking of Gage, there he is, number 63, playing right tackle. And I think probably Doosang lining up right next to him. And then you have number 66. Did we go through this on the lineup?
We haven't. You know, 66, Jack Roy, and who else you see out there?
I think Lane is back centering the ball. Lane Evans.
69.
Yeah, I think so. What do we got?
I don't know what we got. We got a.
They didn't even get it. Number 5 coming off the field.
They pull him out for an equipment. May have pulled him out for an equipment. I see him pulling his knee pads down. So that point of emphasis, LHSA this year has really cracked down on. You know, you watch the college game and the Sunday game. They play with those shorts and.
Yep. So in his replacement, number 17, Matthew Hicks, who made the catch. Ball tipped at the boy. They're just getting pressure.
Ball was incomplete. There you go. Head referee is going to call that incomplete.
Well, they needed to, but finish it off. We've got Cooper Brown is in the game as well. In fact, I'm not even. There's Doosang. I think he and Jack Roy are on that left side. Cooper Brown, Gage Oser looks like he might be playing right tackle.
I think they got Hollis Chapman out there on the left side. Number 70.
Yeah, and 77, Cooper Brown back in the game too. He had a heck of a game last week. But finishing my thought, I was walking, coming back from visiting with some of my classmates from 1983, and Gage Oser's grandmother watches us on away games from Covington.
Yeah. All right. I was about to say we were in an illegal formation, but
they corrected it. Here's the screen.
Couldn't hit Hunter.
The screen pass to number 82.
That's Hunter Vaughn. It was set up, too. I think, Hunter catches that. He's probably picks up 15 or so yards on that play.
He couldn't hit his own brother?
Is that his brother?
I guess. I don't know.
I don't know.
Hunter Vaughn. Yeah. Jake Vaughn.
Well, I mean, it could be.
Same school. You know, it might be. There is another Vaughn family, but we'll have to figure that out. We'll have to ask that question. I'm not sure. What Hunter Vaughn is a junior. Jake is a sophomore, so – we didn't really call Hunter Vaughn's name much this year, so nice to do that. But here's Ryan Hicks. Looked like he was going to pass it. What a kick! It is a boomer, and it lands at the 3 and rolls into the end zone, but that ball came firing off his foot.
Yeah. I mean, that ball, had it not rolled in, that would have been a 55, 60-yard kick. But we'll pick up 25 on the net because they'll bring that out to the 20 for a touchback.
Yeah, only 5 yards of offense on that drive. So 3 drives for the Eagles here in the first quarter, and they only have 43 yards of offense. And Oakdale has 136 yards of offense, but it's really only 2 plays. Both are 68-yard runs, one to the far side of the field as he caught the edge on the second play of the game, and then on their first play of their third drive, right up the middle, for 68 yards. And now they got 80 to go, and let's see if the Eagles can not get fooled by all the fake handoffs and start tackling some guys. And there's the runner up the middle, and they kind of clogged that up, but 5 yards on the pickup to the 25-yard line, second down and 5.
Yeah, and at this point, you know, if you're Oakdale, what you've normally been running, you've had some success and broke 2 of them. You're probably just going to stay with it and see what you can do here with the offensive line doing what they're doing.
Getting up to 6-0 Tioga over Peabody right now. The latest update we have. And here's the pitch, way to the outside. Got to get over. Don't overrun him. And they're going to take him down. He's big. He hauled about 2 Eagles with him, and 2 more had to come in to finish him off as Drake Aldridge, T-Sam, Jaden Williams, and Cooper Scott all in there. Normally you see Cooper takes him down on the first hit. Drake does too, but number 6, Derek Green, carrying some folks.
Yeah. I think he's going to get a first down out of that. I'm not sure. Yep.
Well, it is close.
Bring up 1st and 10. Stretched the play out pretty good. They still got about 5 yards out of it.
We're going to try to keep track of some games that folks might be interested in.
Good play.
There's a drop behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I think that's number 14, Carson Harrison.
With the big tackle on first down, that's going to be a loss of about, six or seven yards.
That's what Menard here needs here. Bring him up, you know, second and long. And
they're going to have to make sure tackles for sure. Under a minute to go here in the first quarter. The Eagles trail 12-0, and it's been quick and kind of shocking. And I'm sure shocking to them. I don't think they anticipated Oakdale being able to run up the gut on the Eagles. We've been able to shut that down for the most part. They have spread it out a little bit. Now they've spread everybody out. Only one running back. The throw to the sideline caught, and it is hit and tackled. Nice job by the defender. That's only going to be about a six-yard gain.
I think that was Jaden. Was that Jaden? Who was that out there on that tackle? Jaden Williams or
no? Maddox Shelton, Maddox, number four.
Yeah,
he closed quick, made the hit right after the catch, gained the lost yardage back. Third down and 10 from the Oakdale 30, and they may get this off before the quarter ends. 3 seconds, they won't get it off. And we're going to carry it into the second quarter. We'll be back with the second quarter and the third down play and see what the Eagles can do about this 12-0 lead by Oakdale. We're back right after these messages.
I'm Kimberly Harrell, Certified Residential Appraiser. I am currently a leading provider of appraisal services for mortgage lending, employee relocation, estate planning, and community property settlements. My experience in real estate over the past 13 years and currently serving as president of the Greater Central Louisiana Realtors Association has given me a clear understanding of the real estate world and the ever-changing market we live in today. For any of your valuation needs, give me, Kimberly Harrell, a call.
All right, and we're back live here in Alexandria, Louisiana. Your Menard Eagles trail 12-0 at the start of the second quarter. Oakdale with a third and 10, now moving left to right on the football field. And Eagles defense has to come up big here and force a punt. And tackling is going to be key. Four is in motion. Up the middle, the handoff. Cooper Scott hit, drags him down, about a six-yard gain. It's going to set up fourth and four, and that might be enough to scare Oakdale into punting.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, and looking at him on film, their punter can kick the ball pretty good. He kicks it pretty deep. It's no Ryan Hicks. He's not going to put it up with a lot of hang time, but he can get a lot of yardage out on it. And, you know, this series reminds me of that play, Carson Harrison, right on first down, taking that play back, good six, seven, 8 yards. And that's what helped Menard bring up this fourth and five play here.
That's right, because they got the six back on the second down and picked up six here. So without that, they're still rolling. They already had a first down. The snap rolls to the kicker, and that is a nice punt in the air. We're not going to get to it, and it will roll dead and out of bounds at about the 32 or 33-yard line of Menard. And we'll see. It looks like it's going to be set at the Menard 32-yard line. Eagles down by 2 touchdowns, 12-0. We've got an update. Alexandria, the Trojans lead West Monroe 7-0, and that's in the second quarter. Leesville over Eunice 21-0. We got Rose Pine and Avoyles tied at 0, so no update from over there. Plaquemine leads Faraday 20-0. Washita Christian over Grant 21-0. Oh, Freddie Hallman, speaking of that, in the crowd tonight.
Oh, Menard
former
coach.
Menard coach, probably one of the last times we won district. Chris, we think we won it with Chris. That's going to be
– I think they may get our motion guy going upfield
cut it up
soon. Yeah, like, is that number 17?
Was that Hicks? It was either 5 or probably 17. Coming down because Jordan's usually set on the outside.
Or a false start on the far side, I'm not sure. But they called false start. I'm not sure if it was the man in motion or far side receiver.
So a 5-yard loss for the Eagles, and they'll have to go 15 yards now. Tioga leads Peabody 6-0 on the latest update. Bunky over Bolton 6-0. Lolly. West Ouachita 14, Pineville nothing. Jake Vaughn in the shotgun, trips to the left, and Aiden Moran going to try to get to the edge. And, man, he's got speed, but not as much as Oakdale.
No, but still, you know, he was able to pick up 5-6 yards there, hit the little hole, and, of course, those linebackers, 3 and 10, 14, come flying out there. But still a good 5-yard pickup right there by Aiden.
Boy, latest up to Marksville, 24, Buckeye zip.
Well, that's a shocker.
That is a shocker. I'm sure Coach McLaughlin is shocked at that. He joined us on the Coach Speak show, which will be 5 o'clock every Sunday. We're live from Quibido's. They are closed. So if you see the cars in front of Quibido's, don't come in. It's just us. Jake rolling out, got a man open, caught by Gavin Hilton. First down, Eagles. And that is a nice, nice play by Jake running to his throwing side to the far side of the field. First down, Eagles with a big, 12-13-yard pickup.
Couldn't have executed that more perfect, Jake, with a good play action right there in the backfield. Rolled out to his right, Gavin ran a great route out route there, and Jake hit it right on the money. Good catch by Gavin.
Eagles trail 12-0 with 10 minutes to play in the first half here on Homecoming Night. Speaking of Homecoming Night, we will have, hopefully the dance line will do a routine, and maybe not, because they do all their homecoming festivities, announcing the king and queen, but they do it after the dance, right? Here's Aiden Moran being patient. He's going to fall forward and maybe pick up a yard. I don't know. Why are they marking it back here? He wasn't down.
Yeah.
And then, that's a bad spot.
He kind of cut it back inside.
He did. And he was still – moving his feet and fell past the 45. Yeah. They're only going to give him about a yard. Should have been about 3.
So I think going to your halftime, I think Dance Line did their routine last night because we have homecoming. And you can look, you know, the number of girls we have down there on homecoming court.
Oh.
Guys, so going to crown the queen tonight at halftime, I'm sure.
Crown the queen and the king. And that'll take up – they'll probably have about a 15-minute, maybe 20-minute halftime. So we'll show the video a little bit. Here's Jake Vaughn rolling out. Got to get rid of it. It went forward. It hit a lineman. That's not a fumble. It's incomplete. Yeah, did that hit Dusang before it hit the ground? That would be an illegal touching, wouldn't it?
Potentially, but the ball could have been deflected right there at his hand also too.
Jake has got to get the ball out a lot quicker than that. I mean, just throw it out of bounds.
Well, and knowing you're going to have pressure from Oakdale. I mean, that, you know, on film, they come hard. They rush hard. Their defensive line rushes hard. Their defensive ends rush hard. If you look back at the Vols offense and you look at how Vols put a lot of points on them, is that they caught that defense really coming upfield. And the Vols offense loves a defense like that. So I think that's why they had that success.
Moving in motion, that is 17. He's getting around the edge. There's a pass over. Oh, nice defense over the middle. That's double covered. I think he had Matt Hicks, but Matt wasn't even looking, so it would have hit him in the back of the head. So the Eagles pick up a first down but can't move it any further as they get it out to about the 43-yard line. That's about 15 yards of offense. No, 11, excuse me. I'll have better math. 11 yards of offense, and Ryan Hicks will come in to punt. And hopefully, boy, he nailed one on his last one. It came flying off of his leg. They're going to move all the way back to the 15-yard line. And here is Hicks. And this is a nice ball. It's going to fall short and bounce and roll and just let it go inside the 10. They'll mark it at the 10-yard line.
10 or 11.
11-yard line as Maddox Shelton grabs it. So Oakdale, a great opportunity for the Eagles right here as they have Oakdale deep in their own portion of the field. We have 8:52 to go in the half. Eagles trail 12-0, and we're going to keep it here. Rebels of West Monroe tie Ash now at 7-7. Still 21-0, Wampus Cats over Eunice. Faraday trailing 20-6. 7-7, Ash and West Monroe. Still nothing of Oils and Rose Pine. That's another one right there. Rose Pine, if could pull the upset, then Avoyelles wouldn't have a chance to be co-champs if Oakdale is able to hang on here and the Eagles unable to come back. There's a nice tackle by the defense. They weren't fooled on that one. Asher Davis coming in, who's normally taking people out, but this time he took the running back out for a loss of about 3 yards.
Yeah, good play by the defensive front and Asher and crew, and good penetration there and able to get back there and disrupt that.
Coach Scully looking like maybe a few adjustments maybe to be able to do something better against this defense as they were getting the better of him. As another loss on first down sets up second down and 12. See if the Eagles can keep moving them backwards. Under center is Johnson. He hands it off, and they're going to take him down. Oh, he breaks a tackle. Cooper gets him and drives him back. And it's going to be a gain of about 4. And they're gonna say about third down and 8 for Oakdale. Got to get this one. Got to stop this one and pick up the best field position. Hopefully, we had it at the 50 a couple of drives ago. Oakdale with their 5th drive in the half. See what the defense can do here. Third and 8 from their 12-yard line. They hand it off. He's still got it going to the outside. He's got the first down by about a yard or two.
Yeah, he's going to have it. He right past the needed the 21. He got about 21 and a half, 22.
He never pitched it. He faked the handoff up the middle, went outside, had his pitch man, but held on to it. Number 31, Branson Buller coming into the game. T. Sam Bracata coming out.
That's Jack Simpson, 22, coming out. Sam still in, 20.
Oh, 22, that's right. Some reason I keep seeing 20 on that shirt. Jack Simpson, I got to make sure I write that name down. I always pull a different roster every game. Here's Johnson. He gives it up the middle and breaking tackles, rolling over people, and, boy, the – official needs to get out of there. He's not moving fast enough.
That was Carson Harrison on the tackle there with assist by the umpire.
Jack Simpson, right?
That's going to bring up another first down here right past 31.
Yeah, they've taken it from their own 11-yard line, and they're now out to the 31. So the defense needs to bow up here, 6:20 and counting in the first half. Cannot afford to fall behind by 3 touchdowns. They need to stop them here so they can try to start their comeback up the middle. Boy, he is just breaking some tackles and falling forward. He refuses to go down backwards.
Yeah, picks up about 3 right there.
Out to the 34. Oakdale, 34-yard line. I can't tell if that's number 6 or 2 or 4. Now, 2's coming out. That's the receiver near side. They got 2 receivers set, and they run that wing T triple threat. And they'll send somebody in motion. The far side running back does. He fakes the handoff. Got to hang on. Oh, what a great job by T. Sam Bracata. They're going to get a face mask.
I think they might get us on a face mask here.
T. Sam holding his hand from ripping the mask.
Yeah.
But T. Sam probably in that initial hit grabbed the face mask. A little late on the flag coming out. Maybe he got stuck in his pants or something. But T. Sam was able to turn around and get back into the tackle.
Yeah,
after initially missing it.
Yeah, it was a good play on the left edge to get the quarterback to go back inside. That's what you're trying to get, right? Either get a pitch or a commit from him back inside. They got him turned back inside, came in to clean up the tackle, and unfortunately just, athleticism sometimes of those other players cutting around and you're trying to make plays and get your hand out there, and it happens.
Yeah, I think they missed it by 5 yards.
Unfortunately.
So they got to move it out their back. They're now into Eagle territory at the 49-yard line. First and 10, Oakdale. from the Eagle 49, 5:15 and counting in the second half. You know, it's just vital here to end this drive for the Eagle defense to stop this drive and keep them from putting it in the end zone. They're going to fake come back. Everybody's set under center. Now he's moving, coming near side. The pitch goes to the outside and just breaking tackles.
Yeah.
That was Jaden Williams who broke down but just let him get by.
Yeah, we had a guy outside, but, of course, by the time you're that far out, he cuts it back upfield and picking up 7-8 yards on that.
Got it out to the Eagle 42, setting up second down and short. Looks about 3 yards for the Oakdale Warriors. Drum corps playing, trying to get everybody fired up. Got the cheerleaders and the dance line trying to do their thing. Oh, there's Al Matthews and the crew bringing in the hamburgers for halftime. They have taken care of us all year long with hamburgers, french fries, sometimes some sausage, you name it. But they bring it up. It's offsides. It should be a penalty. Moving left tackle moved early. And we're going to see a big play. And he just won't go down. That might be a flag on 17.
Yeah.
Throwing him late on the sideline to the ground. And they're going to tack on 15 more. And this is not the Eagle team that we're accustomed to seeing picking up these personal foul penalties.
Yeah, frustration coming out there, you know, on the edge and getting the penalties like that and seeing the team kind of hit the edge like they are and having some success on the outside and defense just getting frustrated.
Should have never made it to there because the left tackle moved.
Did look like it had a little
early
movement.
4 minutes and 2 seconds left in the half, and this is going to take it down inside the Menard red zone, the Red River red zone, down to the 18-yard line as the Oakdale Warriors are down inside the 20 and that Red River red zone. Thank you, Red River Bank, for being a sponsor this year and last year of Menard football. Hopefully we'll get you for all the schools next year. But it is a community bank started in Alexandria by Blake Shotlane. And, man, you know, several folks from Menard are working there, Jack Brahm and others. But we're grateful for their sponsorship. Here's the handoff up the middle, and that one is nicely blocked. That's what we're accustomed to seeing is stopping it either for a loss or just for maybe a yard gain. And it's going to set up 2nd and 9. Menard still has 2 timeouts, but not sure they want to use them here. Wouldn't be surprised if they wouldn't mind just going into halftime only down by 2 scores.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. With Oakdale with 2nd and 9 here inside your 20-yard line.
Let that clock roll and just hope the defense can pull a stop here. Well, we know they're not going to kick a field goal because they don't even kick an extra point. 12-0 the score with 3:20 to play in the first half. Dakota Johnson under center. And we'll see who goes in motion this time. And it is the far side back. Handoff up the middle. That is number 60. Ben Good on the tackle. Grabbed him from behind and held on for only about a 3-yard gain. And that's going to set up a 3rd and 5. Pick up the first down at about the 9. Maybe a little on the inside edge of the 9-yard line. 2:50 and counting. 12-0 Oakdale over the Menard Eagles.
Yeah, Menard. Third and about, what, 6, Tom?
Close to that, yep. 2:35 and counting. Now 18 seconds on the play clock. Oakdale kind of letting the play clock run down. Dakota Johnson under center, under 10 seconds on the play clock. He looks to be looking at it in motion. They give it to the man in motion. He's tackled. That's well short. That maybe a 2-yard gain set up 4th and 5, and you know they're going to go for it.
Well, and I like what the defensive front did there. Your defensive lineman just hit the ground and piled those offensive linemen up right there trying to clog that inside up and let the linebackers make the play, and they did.
Well, you know, that's
kept
what
– kept that yardage short.
That's how we've been playing all year long doing that, and maybe Coach Scully kind of changed that up a little bit because everybody sees it on the film.
Normally Asher's getting double-teamed there on the nose tackle position, but we saw the line do it there as a group and kind of clog the offensive line up a little bit.
So here it is, big play, 4th and 5 with 1:40 left. In motion, the far side running back. They pitch it out to him, trying to catch the edge, and he's going to have to cut it back inside. Let's make a tackle, guys. And they will, and they're going to stop him short. And it's going to be a turnover on downs as they stop him at the 11-yard line, and the Eagles will take control of the football with 1:26 to play. Great job by this Eagle D.
Couldn't get a number on who that was that came flying up from the secondary out there. I don't, for some reason, I want to say 21, but I'm not sure if that was it or not. But regardless,
Oakdale,
good play.
Oakdale took it from their own 11 to the Menard 11-yard line with the help of 2 15-yard penalties. They got 30 yards on penalties right there to get it all the way down there.
Get your tickets ready, y'all. We're going to be announcing the split.
78-yard drive. I mean, they are killing us in yardage, and they have a 12-0 lead. Eagles just need to hang on to the football here as they start from their own 11 on their 5th drive. I mean, it would be great if we could score, but just hang on to the ball. And this is going to be Gavin Hilton following Cooper Scott. He's going to pick up 4 yards or just shy. Oh, there's a penalty. Hope that's not on us. Hopefully it goes against Oakdale and we pick up 15. 1:26 as the clock stops for the penalty. We'll see what they call. It's going to be against Oakdale. It's got to be a personal foul with it occurring after the play. We'll see what the call is.
He's got a personal foul against Oakdale.
That'll push us out from the 15 to the 30-yard line with 1:27. That opens up a lot more offense opportunity for Menard, not being stuck deep in their own territory.
Yeah. Now, you got to remember here, that was a running play, so the clock
will start
running. Yeah, the clock's going to be running.
Once they set it and blow it in, got to wait for the white hat. There he goes. We're going up 1:26 and counting. Well, we haven't started the clock yet, so home field advantage there. There it goes. Jake Vaughn in the shotgun. Oh, no, Gavin Hilton going to throw. Got a man open. Matt Kirk. Oh, he couldn't hang on. Got two receivers in the same area. Drake Aldridge, the two tight ends. I know Kirk lines up at a wide receiver spot as well, but they were both right there.
Yeah,
something's wrong with that play.
The same route and hit Kirk, and, of course, the defender hit him as soon as the ball got to him.
Got a timeout or they stopped the clock.
Well, we had an incomplete pass.
Oh, it was incomplete pass. That's right.
But I think they ran some off of it afterwards, so they've got to put some back on.
Yeah, I think that's what they're discussing here. Tell you what, let's take a quick break while they figure out how much time should be. Maybe go to the Menard sponsors so we can come right back. We'll be back right after these messages. Well, that took a lot quicker than I thought it was going to. 1:14 to go in the first half. The Eagles at their own 30-yard line need to go 70 more yards, actually, for the touchdown. They could make it a little shorter than that if we could get open. Gavin Hilton trying to break free, going to pick up a decent amount of yardage, maybe 4 yards or so. But we've got a Cooper Scott carrying that block all the way out and now walking back. We got to be a little bit quicker than that. I mean, We got Ryan Hicks. We don't have to score a touchdown.
And we got 2 timeouts.
I mean, we got an opportunity to get into field goal position. We don't have to go that far. Woo, we got some food coming in here, John. Look at this.
Oh, wow.
Wow. That's awesome.
Some salted bread, crawfish bread.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah,
here it
that
is.
That looks pretty good.
This is Cooper Scott. Man, he gets nailed, and they're keep driving them back. Thank you very much. Sausage bread?
I think, you know, I was talking to Waylon LaRue before the game. They had the smoker going down there, and he said he was going to hook us up. So,
oh,
I think,
man,
he may have.
He did. Thank you, Waylon. Got to make sure Jeffrey gets up here.
Yeah, I think we'll be able to let this clock run out here. Yeah,
so the Eagles are going to trail by 12 at halftime during homecoming. Not the homecoming score that they wanted. Let's see. We'll watch the second half and see if we can have a comeback by the Eagles Enjoy your halftime. We got the interns Jeffrey and Andrew coming up. They've got a couple of interviews that they're going to do. You're going to see a little bit of the parade yesterday from Andrew, and they're going to talk to the student council. And, of course, we have the halftime activities that will be taking place, and they'll have the announcements of the winners. So we'll be back right after these messages, about a 30-second timeout, and we're back with Andrew and Jeffrey.
Wherever you are, you're there for a reason. You shouldn't have to make a trip to the branch to deposit a check. Skip the trip and use our mobile app to easily and securely deposit checks right from your phone, day or night, wherever you are, or whatever you're doing. Download our mobile app today.
Is your vision just not as crisp and clear as it used to be? Are you having difficulty driving, especially at night? Are you over 40 and now needing reading glasses? If so, the trusted eye care team at Wallace Eye Associates is here to help with your family's eye care needs, just like we have been for nearly 40 years. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
All right, we are back. This is the Wilder Group Halftime. We'll get Jeffrey in here. And this, of course, is brought to you by the Wilder Group, your friends in real estate. If you want to buy a house or sell a house, you could call the number on screen right there, or you can call Tom at 318-792-6755. And, of course, we have a couple of videos for you guys today. We have two special videos, one for the student council and one for the... Yesterday I went out actually and filmed the homecoming parade and everything, so we'll show that too. And we're just going to jump right into it real quick because I don't know if we'll have enough time or not. So, okay. So we're actually going to show the homecoming court right now, and we'll be back with those videos after this.
It all started with a sketch on a napkin. An idea created by two walk-on bench warmers. And after 10 years of hard work and perseverance to turn their dream into a reality, it's the number one sports bar in America.
Welcome to Walk-On.
Walk-Ons, because everyone needs a little playing time.
course, this is the homecoming court. They're introducing them. But we're going to go to our quick video real quick, and we'll be back. Hopefully, they'll announce the queen and king. So, hope you enjoy this little intern video that I did. What's your favorite part about homecoming?
Definitely the activities, like throughout the week. They're so much fun.
I just love the dance and just getting ready and getting pretty.
Okay, yeah, both of those, honestly.
I like getting dressed up and wearing long dresses. And I like having fun and getting my makeup done.
My favorite part about homecoming is the way it brings our class together and the excitement around it and how our school just becomes one big family.
Probably the theme days. I think they're a lot of fun just to be different from everyone else and just have some fun.
Making memories with my friends.
I love how each day at school we each have a different theme and we get to dress up
for the theme.
It's really fun and we get to see what everyone thinks of. It's really fun and creative.
What is your favorite part about homecoming?
The dance and the dinner before it.
Alright, why should your float win?
Because I think we put a lot of creativity into it and we have a live dog.
Alright, why should your float win?
Because we're seniors.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, seniors on top. We're duh. Yeah.
I think our float should win because we put a lot of hard work into it and it really shows school spirit.
Our float should win because it's very creative and it's very colorful and there's a lot going on and yeah.
Well, everyone put a bunch of effort and hard work into it and we like to represent the class of 2029 and everyone just put a lot of time and effort and it looks really good, so go 7th grade.
I think we just did overall very good on our float. We painted well. We put all of our colors nice. So, and everyone else didn't do as well as ours.
Of course, this is the parade. There's a lot of people out there, Jeffrey. I mean, especially towards the end.
Sure. Yeah, unfortunately, I wasn't able to make it. So, I was going to ask, how did you do this by yourself, or did you just walk around? I mean, who recorded you? Did you just record them while you asked questions and stuff like that?
Well, basically, yeah, I just recorded them and I asked them questions. And, of course, I didn't have an audio mic or anything, so I kind of edited it so they could hear the people in the video. So, yeah, of course, this is the turn you go to the school. You turn around there and then this is the inside of the pep rally after they did the parade. They had a pep rally, of course the drum corps was there, and you'll see the cheerleaders, both junior high and high school, and of course the dance line is there, of course. Yep. The high school.
It looks like it was a good time.
Yeah, it really was. I mean, the pep rally was around 30 minutes or so. Of course, the Eagle mascot. They did a pretty funny dance routine. Of course, I think that's the pep rally.
Yeah.
I think. Yep. The dance line, and if you've been watching, last week we interviewed the soccer team. I'm pretty sure that is Jad from the soccer team who kind of like did the whole pep rally, like announced all the people and everything. And I was like, whoa, that's pretty cool. Yeah. Good to see people that we've interviewed.
Yeah, connect. You know, you get to understand, but to know people. Guys, so we ain't gonna let them show it. Tomorrow night, we're district champions, baby.
Of course, you should have heard Coach Perkins there, had a little speech, and I mean it was really fun little experience. I mean, my high school, I was like smaller than Menard, so we didn't even have big pep rallies or big homecoming. We didn't have floats or anything like that.
Sure.
So, I mean, it was a really fun experience going out there and recording everyone.
What was the theme of the event? Do you remember?
Yeah, it was supposed to be carnival.
Okay.
And they had, some floats had elephants and popcorn, of course, you saw, and stuff like that. And, I mean, yeah, it was pretty cool. They had clowns, too. Just nice. Funny stuff like that.
Yeah, sounds so like a good time.
Yeah, and if we go on to the main field right now, we're still introducing homecoming courts. Of course, that's pretty sure that is Jacob Janice, looks like, number 30 or
Cooper
18.
Scott.
Cooper Scott, okay.
Oh, 33 right there?
33, okay.
Yeah.
Cooper Scott's out there. And I'm not sure if they're going to announce the queen yet. Okay. Looks like they're close to announcing the queen and king. Looks like they said homecoming royalty or something
yeah,
like
I
that.
Yeah, I missed a few things, so I'm not really sure what where they're at right now. Usually they introduce like the king and queen at the end, so I don't believe we're there just yet.
All right, well, we'll keep an eye on it for you guys all at home, and we're going to play our student council video. We had an interview, Jeffrey interviewed them around a week ago. So keep in mind that this was a week ago and not like recent, and I hope you all enjoy.
All right, we're back with the Eagles coaches show, and I have John and Ben. So, John, how did you get involved in student council?
You know, my mom was always involved growing up, and she just kind of gave me that like that push to go and try it in seventh grade, and I've always stuck with it since.
Gotcha. Ben, how about you?
My mom kind of just said, like, hey, you need to try new things. So I just went out and, like, said, all right, I guess I'll go try student council and see what it's like. And I'm here senior year doing it now.
Dang. So what do y'all do, like, as student, like, for student council members or people? Like, what's y'all's objectives and what do y'all do on a regular basis?
You know, throughout the school year, we do a lot of stuff. Like, right now our main task is homecoming. Like, that's next week, and we've been doing that since the beginning of school. But we also do, like, smaller events, like recruitment for students younger and stuff. But we'll also help out with, like, orientation, and then we have a Deck the Mall that we do in December. And then we have other events in the second semester.
Okay. So, Ben, do y'all have, like, a weekly, like, maybe meeting or something like that?
Yes, sir. Every single Thursday at 7:15, we'll meet, and we'll just go over, like, what we need to get done for homecoming and, like, what needs to be done. That's usually what the fall is like. As we get later in the year, they kind of dimmer down, but throughout the fall it's busy all the way up to homecoming, and then from there it's just like, all right, it's flatline, but it's still like very progressive throughout the year though.
Got you. So how was the, well, how do you become on this, like, how do you join? Is it like an election kind of thing or just volunteering? How does that work, John?
So like if you're running for a class office, it's usually like elected within the class, so you'll run for a certain position, and then you'll give a speech, and then your peers will vote for you. And then once you get to like the higher parts, like of executive board, that's usually appointed within like the faculty and like the sponsor.
That makes sense. Yeah, I remember it's been a little bit, but yeah, I remember like they give all those speeches in front of the whole class. You sit there, and but then there's some that are really good, and you're like, oh man, I gotta vote for that guy. But How has it been instrumental in your time here at Menard? How has it, like, got you involved, Ben? How has it just how's it improved or added on to your experience at Menard?
Really, it's just, like, it keeps you busy in the fall. So I play baseball, so it's, like, springtime. I'm really busy. In the fall, it just gives me a time to, like, get involved with the school, and everyone gets to know who you are, and you kind of just become, like, a popularity type thing and getting to know people. Especially the younger ones that just start Menard, and they're like, oh, I don't know anything about the school. It's great to be, like, one of the role models there for them. And that's really the biggest thing it's made, is you just get to grow and make new connections with younger kids.
Sure. John, how about you? How's this made your experience at Menard better?
Man, like, it's made me meet, like, so many new people and, like, branch out and, like, break out of my shell. Like, it's changed me completely, like, for the better.
That's good. That's what any, I guess, extracurricular kind of event's supposed to do. So you mentioned it already, but I actually had planned on talking about it. So, Ben, I'm just going to pretend, because I really don't know anything about homecoming at Menard.
Right.
So where is it located? Is it going to be in the gym or?
So this year, I think it's in the gym. Again, we had it last year in the gym, and it was a really good turnout. It looked great. Like, we did a really good job on it. So I think we could do it again in the gym this year. Past couple of years, I think my sophomore year, we had it on the baseball field.
Really?
It was hot. And then junior year was the gym, but freshman year, COVID kind of knocked it out, so we didn't get to have it. But last year was a great turnout, and it was by far one of the best ones that we've had.
That's good. John, you can answer this one. When is it? I know it's like this next week. Is it like, when is the actual event though? Is it like Saturday or?
The dance is Saturday night, but the parade is Thursday night.
Okay, that makes sense. And what are y'all doing necessarily? Like, how do y'all assist in the actual production, and what are y'all doing to help promote and push forward these homecoming events? And I know the floats are a big thing, right?
Right.
Yeah, big thing.
So each class does decorate a float, which, I mean, that takes, like, multiple hours, like, multiple practices, or not practices, but, like, building sessions. So, I mean, you could spend up to 12, 15 hours working on a float with your classmates, which, I mean, that can get aggravating, obviously, you know, with some people that you may not like. But, I mean, you get to that bond together.
So, go ahead.
But, like, as an executive board, it's more of, like an overall, like, what's going into the overall event.
So, you're like an overseer, maybe?
Right.
In a way. So, do y'all get to participate in any events, Ben? Or is it just y'all kind of oversee things? Do you get to build a float or help? I mean, maybe for class,
so
right?
So, for me, I'm the class vice president. He's the president of everything. So, he kind of just oversees all of our stuff, makes sure we're up to date with all of our certain whatever it may be. But for me, I'm part of, like, the class of 2024 being, like, vice president. And then we have our president, Maren Moros. But so, we make the float, and then we'll present it. And we won't have a lot of people because, like, everyone's on court this year. So it's a little died down. But in the past couple of years, it's always been a big turnout for us having the class float. And it's fun, I will admit. But it's something you get aggravated, like you said. But, yeah.
Sure. And how will there be anything special for the football game on Friday?
So we'll have court presentation at halftime. And, you know, overall, it'll just be a great atmosphere with, like, multiple events going on around the track.
Sure.
So, yeah, it'll be a great atmosphere for everyone.
Sounds great. I want to ask you both specifically. So, John, why would anybody want to join student council? Just maybe plug into any freshman who may be interested in the future, or just, you know, just give them something.
So, there's this organization that we're part of. It's called LASC. And working your way up the ladder will get you, like, to this program. And, I mean, you meet, like, the most amazing people you'll meet in your life. It's, like, people like you that are leaders in their school. And it's really, like, a teaching experience to, like, what it's like to be a leader.
Gotcha. Yeah. So why would you recommend someone join student council?
Really for the bond. The bond in your grade is a big, big thing that you go through high school. High school is really hard. Finding people, especially coming as a freshman instead of an eighth grader. But joining something, getting involved with it, if you play a sport, if you don't play a sport, student council is a big, big thing where you're like, I have this little set of friend group I see Thursday morning, and we're all really close. And if we're really close, we have a great bond. We'll go out and eat one night. We'll go do something. So I say having that friend group is probably one of the best things you can ask for, and having people that also have the same ideas that you have. And if they don't have the same ideas, then you'll elaborate. But having those friends are really what makes high school fun, and that's why I would join.
Definitely. I mean, I know, like, that's a common thread for at every extracurricular sport or any groups. It's always a group. And I know even for me, with my high school experience, always just being with people and getting to know people and growing closer, because that's when you really do get to grow close,
yeah,
is in those groups. All right, so that's it. That's all I have for everybody.
Yes, sir.
And I would like to plug quickly the raffle. I just wanted to bring that back up. I believe, I don't know what week we're on, but, you know, the third week, okay. So third just week, keep yeah. that in mind, people, because, you know, there's some significant money on the line here. So, and it's just $25, I believe, for a ticket.
That's it. I think it's 25, yeah.
25. So, hey, $25, and you can win
a thousand.
A thousand
each week, yeah.
Eventually, 4,000.
Exactly. What a turnaround. So, well, we'll be back in after a few ads, and Tom will carry it off with the coaches.
Yes, sir.
For a lifetime of the
All right, we are back, and we hope you guys enjoyed that short little video of student council, but we have the, what do we have? We have the winners of the float and the king and the queen, of course.
And other people.
And other people, of course. I mean, tell us a little bit about who won.
Well, our baroness is Anna Shillette and Baron Andrew Cowart.
The count was John Eric Laborde, and the countess was Lauren G.
Princess Mallory Brunet and Prince Ryan Hicks.
And the queen was Ellie Juno, and the king was Cooper Scott.
All right. Well, we didn't get to show. I don't think they announced it while we were in the video, but.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. Well, that's good. But we hope you guys at home are happy with whoever won, of course. And we are about. I'm not really sure. It doesn't have it on the clock how much time left we have until the game starts. But, of course, we have some games around Central Louisiana we'd like to list off. If
sure.
Jeffrey, if you can.
I have to scoot in a little bit, but we'll get there. So, let's see. Make sure this is enough. The Ouachita Christian Eagles are beating the Grant Cougars 42-0 at half. The Idalia Vikings are beating the Madison Jaguars 8-6. The Eugenia Giants are beating the Caldwell Parish Spartans 30-7. The Ash Trojans are beating West Monroe 10-7. Oakdale, of course, is beating Menard 12-0. Peabody is beating Tioga 12-6. West Washtenaw Chiefs are beating the Pineville Rebels 14-0. The Eunice Bobcats are beating the Leesville Wampus Cats 24-21. The Green Devils are beating the Faraday Trojans 34-14. The Bunky Panthers beating the Bolton Bears 40-0. The Marksville Tigers beating the Buckeye Panthers 44-21. And we have a few games that aren't listed. They're listed, but there's no scores next to them right now. We have the Rosemont Eagles and the Willis Mustangs, Texans Panthers versus Black Bears, Delta Charter Storm versus the Delhi Chapter Gators, Westminster. Oh, all of those games, they're just zero right now. So we have, there's like a good bit of them that haven't, there's no scores connected to them. But anyways, but those are the scores that we have. And if we want to talk about all right, well, we're about to go to commercial. So I think the game's about to start here in a few, so.
Looks like a minute and 30 seconds.
Okay, so John and Tom will be back just in a minute.
For a lifetime of the best possible vision, look to Wallace Eye Associates, where our tradition of eye care excellence in Senlaw spans nearly 40 years. From your next family eye exam to cataract and glaucoma evaluations, trust your vision to the experienced eye professionals at Wallace Eye Associates. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
It all started with a sketch on a napkin. An idea created by two walk-on bench warmers. And after 10 years of hard work and perseverance to turn their dream into a reality, it's the number one sports bar in America.
Welcome to Walk-On.
Walk-Ons, because everyone needs a little playing time.
We're back live in Alexandria, Louisiana for the second half kickoff. Eagles trail Oakdale 12-yard line, and the Eagles for the second time tonight will have it at the 50-yard line. If anything, that should fire the Eagles up, because Oakdale's basically telling them they're going to have it at their own 49. But Oakdale is saying, we don't think you can move the football.
Well, and, you know, they've been right for the first half, so this is Menard's chance. I mean, ball midfield, we've got to make something happen. We're down two scores, and a new half of football. Let's see if you can come out here and get things turned around.
Yeah, decent job by the Eagles to kind of keep this game at 12-0. And here is Jake Vaughn keeping it himself. Nice pickup of about 8 yards. And the Eagles will have it at the Oakdale 45-yard line. It'll be second down and about 4.
Yeah, good run off right side. They brought in Cooper Scott, had a couple of blockers back there off the right edge, and Jake able to cut it back inside and find a hole.
So just the start here of the third quarter, 11:24 and counting. Jake in the shotgun, two receivers.
Jake's out in the slot.
Oh, he sure is.
Gavin back there.
Gavin taking the direct snap. He's going to keep it, try the left side. Got to cut it up. He gets the edge. He's down at the 30, 25.
Yeah, he stepped out right shy of the 35, but really good play by Gavin. A couple moves inside and then busted it back outside and able to use his speed to get outside.
So they're going to mark it at the 37-yard line. It is a first down for Menard, and 11:08 on the clock. As Aiden Moran comes out and Cooper Scott goes in. So they're trying to go to that wild eagle or whatever they call it. At times, Cooper Scott will be back with Jake. Gavin Moran, they're going to flip it back around. And move Jake. Now take Jake back. Nope. Now Cooper Scott talking to Gavin. 13 seconds on the play clock. Jake Vaughn in the slot, and they're going to hand it off to Cooper. He's up the middle, over the 35, down inside, close to the 30-yard line. They'll mark it at the 33, and it'll be a gain of about 3, maybe about 3 yards, maybe 4 now. Yeah. And it'll be a second down and 6. This is the kind of drive the Eagles wanted to have in the first half that they really weren't able to do, maybe just once with that long pass to Jordan Rich.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we weren't able to get a run game established at all, and we're able to hit a few passes and had that screen pass open to Hunter Vaughn we couldn't connect on and changed a few things up here, made a few adjustments, got a little personnel change-ups, and so far seems to be working.
Two receivers to the far side of the field. Eagles moving left to right. Back is Gavin Hilton. Hands it off to Aiden Moran. He's got a hole up the middle, inside the 20, 15. And the Eagles are inside the Oakdale red zone. Tackled by number 14. They're going to mark it at the 15-yard line. First and 10, Eagles. And they're in the Red River Bank red zone of Oakdale at the 15. Thank you to Red River Bank, your community bank. Member FDIC, and they are all over the state. Makes them a great choice to do your banking if you got somebody, you know, a student in college in any of the major towns. You can transfer money between accounts and take advantage of that opportunity. Here is Gavin Hilton in the shotgun, so changing things up. He's going to follow.
He's got
nice block by Aiden Moran. He's got the edge. Inside, touchdown, Eagles! 9:21 to go in the third quarter, and the Eagles take it down and drive it in for the score, and that makes it 12-6, and Ryan Hicks will go out to kick the extra point and make it a 6-point game.
Good job by Gavin getting out there on the left edge, got some good blocking to seal it, and Gavin used his speed, got out there, cut it back inside, hit the hole, and got the touchdown.
That's a 51-yard drive by the Eagles to kind of say, hey, we're in this game. We've woken up, and we're here for the long haul, Oakdale.
How long was that run?
That run was about 14 yards. 14. It was right, or 15. It was right at the 15. So Ryan Hicks's kick is good, and they have the extra point, which gives them an advantage. They trail only by 6. It is 12-7 with 9:21 to go. We'll be back right after these messages.
For a lifetime of the best possible vision, look to Wallace Eye Associates, where our tradition of eye care excellence in Senlaw spans nearly 40 years. From your next family eye exam to cataract and glaucoma evaluations, trust your vision to the experienced eye professionals at Wallace Eye Associates. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
Time for our red, white, and cool summer event at Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing. Right now, you can save on a new energy-saving system. No money down, 0% interest, and no payments till June 2024. Call Southern Air Heating, Cooling, and Plumbing, or visit us online.
And we're back live at the Eagles' Nest, ready for the kickoff. It is a 5-point lead for Oakdale. The Eagles tacking on the PAT by Ryan Hicks, making it 12-7. And Ryan is in for the second kick the first time. This is a number all the way down, going to be scooped up at the 10-yard line. They got to get down and make a tackle here. Nice. Boy, they do. And he's going to be at the 30-yard line. Kind of odd. Normally we're putting it into the end zone, but maybe just not trusting that we'll have enough speed to get down there and stop the momentum on that run maybe.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think Ryan might have mishit that kickoff, or he kicked a hard squib down there, hoping to get a good bounce. Sometimes you can get those big bounces or hops over the head, and unfortunately didn't get it there. But good coverage by the kickoff team, keep him at the 30-yard line.
That wild eagle formation just going back between Moran and Gavin and Cooper Scott,
yeah.
And moving Jake out, you know, that's kind of messed up Oakdale a little bit. And just what the doctor ordered for the Eagles to drive it in and make this a game with a touchdown actually puts them in the lead, and the defense going to have to do their part right here and stop this Oakdale Warrior team. And that handoff goes up the middle, and he's got a hole taken down after a big gain of about 8. It'll set up a second down and about 2 as we're not clogging that middle up like we were doing in their last couple of drives.
Yeah, and, you know, that triple option can kind of do that to you. You know, your defensive tackles can get out a little wide sometimes with what they're going to see and the misdirection you see, and you get that handoff in there. And I tell you, you know, like a Voles, if that running back can break through that first line and get to the second level, it can be trouble.
Oh, I got to send that update to let our team know that we're on the board here. They're going to look to pass, and that's going to
flags everywhere.
That's going to be an offsides
or false start.
False start. Grant Cougars trail Ouachita Christian 42-0. West Monroe leads Pineville 14.
That's West Ouachita.
Leads Pineville 14-0. West Monroe trailing Ash 10-7 at the half. Peabody over Tioga 12-6. Marksville now leads Buckeye 36-29. What a comeback by Buckeye. Here is the pass. Dakota Johnson going to roll out. They're going to go get him. And, boy, they had him stopped. Now nervous. If they can get back.
He's got the edge
on the near side. Gavin Hilton coming in. Wraps him up but can't take him down. They're going to have to get him in the center of the field, and they take him down finally at the 45. But Gavin Hilton, did you see him close?
He did. Gavin made a great stop, almost finished it off. You know, unfortunately, he's going to scramble for about 18 yards and pick up the first down. But, you know, we had him clogged up over there on the right side, and secondary had the receivers covered and just couldn't make the tackle, couldn't wrap him up. And, you know, that's where the speed and athleticism, you know, can hurt you.
8:04 left in the third quarter. Eagles got their hands on their hips, man. That one tired them out as they had to run all the way to the left side of the field. Missed him. He came near side, and they had to chase him back to this side, and then he went back to the middle. So a lot of running by the defensive line. They're going to go back up the middle. Drake Aldridge does not shut the edge down, but out of bounds for no gain as Cooper Scott chases him all the way into the cheerleaders. Cooper's talking. He better settle it down. We don't need a 15-yard penalty.
Yeah, good play by the defense to pursue him out.
Good job by Principal Gatlin out there to be able to calm him down. Actually, I should say Coach Gatlin, maybe.
I don't know, but he's like Superman. He was wearing a suit about 5 minutes ago.
I know. We were talking about that up here. I mean, he's probably got his shirt and tie on underneath that jacket. He just ripped that off and put a coat on to be able to hand out stuff at halftime. So the Eagles crowned their king and queen tonight, and they're hoping to crown themselves district champs.
Got Maddox 101 with number two on the top out there.
Going to be in motion is six. They hand it, fake it. Nope. They got him. They throw it. Backwards. That's on the ground. Get him. And they're going to take him down for a loss all the way back to the 31, 32-yard line, as that was a live ball, and that is a huge loss on second down. That is a loss of about 12 or 13 yards.
And we,
they're going to say, okay. They
yeah, no, that's where the initial contact was, where the ball should be.
30,
yeah.
At the 35-yard line, so that's a loss of 10.
This is where Menard, you know, we talked about Oakdale can be undisciplined at times, and we saw it there. The quarterback was wrapped up, trying to make a play, just threw it back. All chaos broke loose. And this is where Menard's got to capitalize. We got him at third and 20. Need to force a punt here.
So under center, they just need to hold the edge right here. And in motion goes six. The handoff is up the middle, and the Eagles clog that up for only a 2-yard gain. And that's going to set up a fourth and 13 and a definite punt by Oakdale. What a great job. This is the exact way that they wanted to start the football game, but they didn't. But they got the start in the second half here in the third quarter, scoring on the first drive, taking the ball 49 yards. Maybe Oakdale rethinks that squib kick, you know, onside kick, giving Eagles the opportunity to only have to go 51 yards, which they took advantage of. And now they'll have a chance, hopefully, to catch this ball. We really haven't done that much.
I can tell you, this punter, the way he kicks, it is hard to catch because it's kind of line drive kicks, but this is probably the best you're going
to
get right
Gavin
here.
Gavin Hilton hauls it in at the 35, makes one cut to the outside. He's at the Oakdale 40, knocked out of bounds at about the 39, and that's where they'll mark it. What a great return. He hauled that in at the Eagle 35 and went 5, 10, 15, 20, 26 yards down to the Oakdale 39, and that's where the Eagles will try to take this second drive and take the lead in this one.
That was how many yards, Tom?
That was
that return?
5, 10, 15, 20, 26 yards on 26. The return. Oakdale was at the 30, and they made it down to the 28, right? No.
But we got Gavin back here again, and it looks like Gavin and Aiden got Jake out in the slot. We got an eligible tight end on this side, so maybe look for Hunter Vaughn right here. That's something we haven't looked at.
So the direct snap's going to Gavin. He's getting his exercise tonight.
Good
and
hard run.
I'll tell you what, Gavin Hilton has said, I want this football game. And the offensive line has come out and given him some room to run, but he is running hard.
Yeah, that run right there, you know, was kind of designed probably to go back inside a little bit, and he busted it outside and used his speed to get out there. And Oakdale had it covered briefly, and he puts his head down, makes a good hard run, picks up 7 yards.
Eagle defense getting the drop on second down on that drive.
Brought Cooper in the backfield with Gavin now and Jake going back out in the slot.
Minus 8 yards on the drive for Oakdale, and now the Eagles starting at the 39-yard line of Oakdale. That one, Cooper Scott breaks a tackle. Now he's trying to weave his way in and around to the 30. He's still going. Strong. And they're gonna say his forward momentum stopped at the 31.
Unless they were blowing the whistle early.
He's gonna be short. Third down. That's gonna be at the 31-yard line. Third down. They have to get to the 29. They're marking it at the 32. So they're gonna need 1, 2, 3 yards. Third and 3 with 4:37 to play here in the third quarter.
Well, and you
Eagles
may be,
trail by 5, you know, 12-7.
Being here at the 33, we may be in 2-down territory anyway because
at this definitely. Point. Matt Kirk comes out far side, or near side of the field. He is the deep receiver. Vaughn is the slot. Jordan Rich out to the far side. Gavin Hilton takes it up the middle. Got the first down and more. Down inside the 24, 23. They'll mark it at the 24 of Oakdale. Gavin Hilton has just said, I'm a beast and you can't stop me.
Well, you know, and you look at the physicality of the offense now this half, first the first half, the physicality of the whole team is much better. The offensive line's blocking harder. Running backs are running hard. You know, we're just seeing a much more physical Menard team this second half than we saw in the first half.
They're going to give Gavin Hilton a break and bring him out of the game and let him rest a little bit because he's been playing both ways. He's got an interception. I believe that was him. Oh, no, that was Maddox Shelton. No, Jaden Williams that came down with it. But Gavin's been running the ball hard. So now we go back into kind of a regular Jake Vaughn in the shotgun, and they're going to run him. He takes it left side and just not getting the amount of running room that Gavin's finding, although he picks up about two maybe. Nope, maybe one and a half. Set up a second down. We are getting close to field goal position here.
Yeah, I think, you know, we're within Ryan's range at this point. We're almost to the Red River Bank red zone, 20-yard line.
Almost.
And,
you're not going to leave points on the board if you got a fourth and long.
Yeah, I mean, from where we're at, you're looking at about a 38-yard field goal from where we're at currently, which is within his range.
Yep. Gavin Hilton back in the game with Cooper Scott, Jake Vaughn in the slot, near side field, far side Jordan Rich. Matt Kirk is the other receiver here on the near side, as you see it in the camera. And that's going to be movement. 82.
Yeah, I think they're going to get Hunter Vaughn for rocking back in a stance potentially on a false start.
2:54 to go in the third quarter, and we've got a false start by the Eagles. And that's going to drop them back 5 yards. And it'll be second down and 13. 12-7, the Eagles trail. It would be great if they could take the lead here. A field goal cuts it to 12-10. And then it leaves just a field goal to take the lead. I think we're going to probably need more than 12, you know, more than 12 or 13 points. I know the defense is hoping to pitch a shutout here in the second half, but, you know, depending on how tired they get with that speed that Oakdale has, it's going to be a tough one. Gavin looking to throw. He's got a man open. Caught. Caught by Jake Vaughn.
Yeah.
Down to the 21-yard line. That is a gain of about six, yeah. Five or six.
Well, it makes you third down manageable, brings you up third and seven. And, again, you know, sitting at the 21-yard line, so I think kind of gets you back in Ryan Hicks' field goal range also.
That's got to throw Oakdale for a loop to have Gavin Hilton. That's a whole new wrinkle in the offense that we haven't seen them call using Jake Vaughn as a receiver. He's like a big tight end. Gavin in the shotgun, showing he's got a little arm and some direction with it. He's going to keep it and follow Cooper Scott. Going to get to the outside. He's got a lot of green and a block. Cuts it in. Dives down inside the 10. They're going to mark him at the 11, but that is should be enough for the first down.
Yeah, that was good misdirection. Gavin goes right. We pulled some right side offensive linemen to come down on that defensive end. Got a good block on the left side and sealed it down. And Gavin got outside and got good yardage.
That was a really nice patient run by Gavin as he followed Cooper Scott, who took on a blocker, and that's when he was able to cut it outside. A great block downfield, and he just had to kind of dive in between, picked up the first down. It is first and 10 from the 12 of Oakdale with 1:15. The Eagles have run the bulk of the clock in this third quarter, which is what they did against Rose Pine as well. If they could put a touchdown here, overloading on the right side, let's see if they go back left. And they're going to try to follow it up the field.
Cut.
Gavin Hilton inside the five. And that is going to be second down. They're going to mark it at the five. They're marking these short,
the four,
man.
So, yeah, I'd have to look
they
at
spun
it
him around.
I'd have to look at it and see where his knee hit. Couldn't really tell, but he definitely ended inside the five.
They marked it at the five. Both the line judges marked it at the five. It's going to be second and short. They can get the first down at the two with 30 seconds left in the third quarter. Cooper Scott and Gavin Hilton are back there together. And they got Drake Aldridge. They're going to looks like Drake, somebody. Might be Drake on the edge. They're going to let the clock run down?
No.
Nope. Here's Cooper Scott going to try to bull his way in just short, but he's got the first down at the one.
Yeah. Not sure why they're not killing the clock on this first down play because he's got the first down. They need to be killing it. Referee's going to kill it.
Well, now he kills it with 3 seconds on the clock.
It'll still bring us to the fourth quarter. They'll roll it back. So go to the fourth quarter with first and goal from about the 2 yard line.
Yep. I don't think they're not gonna run a play, and the Eagles trail 12-7 as we head to the fourth quarter, and they head there with a first and goal from the 2, and we'll see what they do when we come back.
Buying car insurance for the first time can be overwhelming. Do you have enough coverage? Are you paying too much? Will someone be there for you when the unexpected happens? I'm Jason Hawk with Farm Bureau Insurance. You may think it's easier online, but why wait? We're here to help you make sure you're covered. When it comes to car insurance, we have the answers, and we may have rates that save you money. So talk to Hawk at 318-791-HAWK or online at talktohawk.com and let us help you protect your biggest investments.
We're back live from Alexander, Louisiana in the Eagles' nest. The Eagles with first and goal from the 1 yard line here as we start the fourth quarter. They trail by 5, 12-7. See if Cooper Scott's going to get this one and just try to bull his way in behind that line. Everybody is blocking hard. This is a different Menard Eagle team here in the second half. And there is going to be an offsides. Is that 82 again on the right side?
I'm not sure who we got. But
Hunter Vaughn, it looks like, on the right-hand side. That's about his third early start. And that's going to move it back to the 5.
Not sure what they're talking about unless the defense induced it, but I think they're going to put it on the false start on the offense.
We've got – the clock has not started to run here in the fourth quarter yet, and they are going to call it as a false start on the Eagles, and that'll move it back to the 6 yard line. So the Eagles have some extra work, but they have 4 downs to do it. And depending on where they are, they're in definite Ryan Hicks territory. I mean, it's like extra point territory. They're going to take the direct snap, see who they give it to. They're going to give it to Gavin. He's going to roll right, and they made the edge, and he may be lucky. He'll get a yard to the 5, and it'll be second down and goal from the 5 yard line.
Yeah, looks like number 12 on the defensive end for Oakdale stepped up. Hunter came in unblocked and wrapped him up, or number 2, I can't tell.
When we were in that commercial break, the Menard sponsors, we want to thank Wildwood Pizza for hosting us on Wednesday nights. We want to thank Michelle LaCour of Polos and Plaids, and we didn't get to do that off the top, but the jerseys and the shirts that we're wearing, our uniforms made by Michelle LaCour at Polos and Plaids, located on Metro Drive. She'll make anything you need for school. Here's a direct snap to Cooper Scott. He's in. Bulls his way in. Touchdown, Eagles. And they take the lead with that touchdown with 13-12. And Ryan
we
Hicks.
We got a flag.
That's going to be extracurricular activity on them if they anything.
Is that a flag down back there? I think somebody threw a flag.
Cooper Scott got dragged down after he was like 8 yards in the end zone. They never stopped tackling him. So, if anything, he may have taken offense to that. And it'll be after the touchdown. If it's against Cooper, he's acting like it is. We'll see. They're going over to talk. Were they asking the coaches, or are they just going to give warnings to the players?
I'm not sure. We're about to see it. It's like we got some
touchdown.
Yeah, touchdown's good. We got an unsportsmanlike on us.
Doesn't look like he's going to put his arm up for a call against.
They're going to put it on the kickoff.
The Eagles get to choose that?
No. Oakdale gets the option if they want it on the try or the kickoff, and they're saying they're going to take it on the kickoff.
So that's one unsportsmanlike conduct on Cooper Scott. He's going to have to watch himself. No more, you know, problem is he had some smart talk, you know, some smack talk on the sideline, if you remember, and he got a warning from the official. And then if he was doing it again, they finally tagged him. But he's got to watch himself because another one, he'll be tossed.
Yeah, you get one unsportsmanlike during the game on your second C ejection.
13-12, Eagles have taken the lead in the fourth quarter. Coach Perkins having a conversation with the white hat. I'm sure he's kind of talking about, oh, Cooper Scott made a muscle, you know, movement. I just saw the official in the end zone. But, hell, I mean, heck, he got pulled down 8 yards in. I mean, they didn't let go.
Yeah.
He was in the end zone already.
Yeah, I don't know if it was a continuation or not, but it's where you got to keep your head. I mean, you're in a close game. Look, I mean, we're in a dogfight right now, and then you got to play smart.
I know you got all that momentum and you're feeling good about the touchdown, but you just got to act like you've been there.
That's right.
Just, you know.
I mean, we're going to need, you know, we're probably, look, I mean, it's still early in the fourth quarter. We're probably going to possibly need some more points here, and of course, we're going to need some big stops from the defense, so still got a lot of football left to play.
Definitely some huge stop. Are we going for two?
Looks like it.
I'm not sure, you know. Way early in the game, and we have a field goal opportunity. We're up by one. That was a touchdown. So you put you got a game clock 12. At 12. Aiden Moran going in. We were a man short. I'm sure he was thinking it was an extra point try. But they're going to go for two, and they're going to fake it. They're going to throw. The pass is caught. Cooper Scott stopped at the one. He can't fall forward, and he is stuffed.
Now that was Hunter Vaughn, 82.
82. Yeah, that didn't look good on his knee.
Number five made that initial stop for Oakdale.
That was an awkward tackle as he was leaning forward and his body was being pushed backward. He's able to put a little bit of pressure on that and kind of walk off with a little bit of help. But I'm sure we'll see Don Fields looking and checking him out as he comes off the line. So the two-point conversion, no good. Not sure about that one. You'd only go up by two. You know, you'd be up by three at 15. They can't kick a field goal, so that's not going to happen.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't seen them kick any field goals, but it is what it is at this point. And look, I mean, we still got a lot of football left. I don't, you know, 1 point, 2 points, it may take another seven to make sure we can seal this, if not two scores. So we'll just have to see what happens.
So Menard with a 61-yard drive for the TD. Capped off by Cooper Scott bullying his way into the end zone for the last 5 yards. 11:13 to go. 13-12 is your score. Menard with a slim 1 point lead. So interesting. It's been a tale of two halves so far, at least a tale of one quarter in the second half. It was 12-0 at halftime, Oakdale. Eagles score a touchdown in the third and add another one here in the fourth quarter.
One, I don't mean to interrupt you, Tom, but, you know, we got a kickoff. We're 15 yards deeper than where we normally are, so you're probably going to see a return here by Oakdale and going to need good coverage on our kickoff team.
Ryan's going to have to kick it pretty deep or squib it, you know, somewhere, and it's going to go high and short. They're not going to give it to the deep man. They're going to haul it in at the 24, and he's trying to get all the way over to the other side. This is number six. He's going to be taken down. That is really good coverage. Derek Green, who had the football, brought down at the 29-yard line. Maddox Shelton slow to get up.
Yeah, that was good coverage, good way to stretch it out. I mean, he took that ball almost on the far sideline here around the 20 and only got it about 8 or 9 yards upfield. Of course, ran to the other side, but good coverage by the kickoff team.
Eagles have 13 points here in the second half. They did not they went for two and missed it. So both teams have tried two-point conversions, and neither one of them have connected on them. Oakdale's tried it twice, and no good. And it's first and 10 from the 29-yard line of Oakdale, and the Eagle D needs another stop. Under center is Johnson. Little movement on the edge, not getting called there. Up the middle, and that will go for about 4 yards.
Yeah, being good on the stop again off that right side of our defensive line.
You get that air turned on again. The it'll be second down and six from the Oakdale 33-yard line. 10.5 minutes left in the game. This has been a good one, and it should be for the District 4 2A title on the line. The Eagles want to own it outright, and if they hang on with the 1 point, they will get it. There's the offsides.
Yeah, we got it. The movement there.
Took them forever.
Number four over here made a little fake, and like he was going to go in motion, then stopped.
Took them forever to make the call. But we got it. Going to back them up five and make it second and long. It'll be second down and 11 from their own 28-yard line. It's kind of talking about our sponsors, the Menard sponsors, M&M Sound, Mike Upshaw, allows us to use a speaker during Wildwood Pizza Night, the Eagles' Nest Coaches Show. Here it is, second down and 11. Johnson under center, fakes the handoff, goes up center himself, breaking hole, picks up 12, and going to be marked at the 40, and that's enough for the first down. Picked it all up, almost broke it for the long touchdown.
Yeah, that was number 11, Johnson, correct?
Yeah, the quarterback. 68, let's see. Kind of doing some math in my head. We're at the 40-yard line now with 9:20 and counting. 13-12 Eagles in the fourth quarter. And he fakes the handoff. Didn't even try to hand it off. Not sure if that was a busted play, but that was a great job by the defense as the little guy. Who was that? That was
Branson Buller, number 31.
And number 7 coming down with him as well.
Yeah.
But it – Good news for us is that he went kind of ran backwards and made a move, and they jumped on him there, and he lost a couple of yards on that move.
Initially, we turned him back inside, which is what you want to do too, right, and let your pursuit get it. Linebackers, he got a little bit of yardage, but like you said, he kind of jumped back, and we were able to finish him off back there.
Give it to the Eagle fans tonight and Oakdale, traveling well on the other side over there. They pretty much fill the guest stands, and they're lined up and down at least the track and the behind the fence over there, heading back toward the parking lot. Here's a pass out to the flat. They tried to close on him, and he's going to pick up the first down.
It's going to be, yep, they're giving it to him.
Marked at the 50. We're laying way off, about 10 yards because of that speed and just not able to read that one as quickly as Carson Harrison did in that first – or, no, who was that? Jaden Williams read it in the first quarter. Got a
Well,
official timeout here. Are they going to measure?
Well, I think he had to line the game. Looks like the ball is at the line. I'm not sure if they're going to measure it or what. Looks like it.
Looks like they're going to measure. We're going to take a quick break. 8:01 to play in the game. 13-12. Eagles lead it over the Oakdale Warriors. You're watching live streaming football, the Menard Eagle football on 446 Sports.
BK Distributors is proud to support high school athletics on 446 Sports. BK is the one-stop shop for trophies, banners, awards, letter jackets, and just about anything award-related. And now, welcome BK Apparel and BK Promotions to the family. For all your Spirit Apparel needs and anything you need to brand your business, when you think of anything you need with your name on it, think BK. Check them out on Facebook or at bkdistrib.com. BK Distributors, apparel and promotions in Pineville.
Appliance Parts Company in Alexandria has all your major appliance parts needs. We sell parts to all major appliances as well as new appliances, including window units, chest, and upright freezers. Appliance Parts originally opened its doors on Lee Street in 1972, and we're now open at a new location on Memorial Drive to serve you better. Stop by, say hey to our crew, and check out our awesome holiday gifts. Appliance Parts, 2208 Memorial Drive in Alexandria next to Target. Open Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, and Saturday from 9 till 12.
They looks like they're going to be short. They got inches, third and inches from inside the 50-yard line, that white stripe right there on the line, and the football is just a nose short. And they may try to just run it up the gut, see if the Eagles can stuff it. But be ready to, with guarding the edges here. And under center, they're going to try to draw him. Nope, they fake it. Now he goes under. He's got the first down. And the clock will continue to run. Well, they'll stop it before they while they set the chains, but he picks up one. A little more, one and a quarter of an inch. 7:44 and counting.
I would imagine had they not got that and we would have stopped them a little short, we'd have had to do it again too.
Yeah. Yep, that's true. Warriors and Eagles territory. What a game. What a game, as I said. For the district championship tonight, Oakdale needs the win to have a tie for the championship. And the Eagles need it to win it outright. Avoyles, see if we can get an update on their score. They lead Rose Pine 8-0 at the half is what it's saying. So they would be tied if somehow Oakdale comes back. They're going to go to the outside. He's got the outside. Going to be run out of bounds at about the Eagle 40. Just shy of the 40, maybe 30.
Tay, I'm not sure if that was a design play or a busted play. The quarterback went left and all his backs went to the right. He was out there by himself, but still was, you know, got out there on the outside and was able to pick up 7 yards.
Yeah, good news. They say he stepped out of bounds at the 43, Menard 43. It's going to be second down and 4 with 6:58 to play in the game. A great crowd tonight on the Menard side as well. I mean, their gate. Probably the biggest gate we've had.
This year for sure, absolutely, yeah.
The stands were packed.
They're in the end zone. They're on the track. They're in the tailgating area, and the Oakdale stands are packed.
Yep. It is a wonderful game and a great night for football, and the Eagles are in it. There's the handoff, and the Eagles stuff it for about a gain of a yard or so.
Yeah, it's going to bring us up about 3rd and 3.
Third and 3. The Eagles with an opportunity here. It'd be a huge stop. They got 2 plays. They're going to have to stop, and then hopefully the offense can run the clock out.
Third down.
I'm just worried. They need a touchdown. The Eagles, just to seal it.
Oh, yeah. Well,
they got to stop them first.
You know, we talked about it the first part of the start of this fourth quarter after our touchdown. We're probably going to need some more points.
Eagles with 2 plays. They got to come through, see if they can gain some push that line back and stuff it. They're going to go fake it. He's going to roll out. They got it played well. Let's see if they can come up and get him.
Man,
tracking down. That's a loss. Cooper Scott, Maddox Shelton, and T. Sam Bracata running that all the way to the sideline. It's going to be a loss of a yard.
You know, that was a designed run the whole way. It's 2 wideouts out here. Inside wideout was obviously they were both on the line and he was ineligible and both of them went downfield to block. It was a designed run all the way and never had the option to pass that ball downfield and kept stretching it out and good play by the defense.
4th and 4 for the Eagles. This has the game written all over it. It's still a lot of football to go with 5:30 and counting, but the way the Eagle offense has been rolling this half, they've used the bulk of the third, almost the whole third quarter of the clock. And some of the fourth. So if they can keep going the way they were going, they're going to have a timeout.
Yeah, okay.
Oakdale wants to talk about it. They'll use their first timeout. We'll take a quick one, and we'll be back right after these messages from our sponsors. This is live Eagle football on 446 Sports. And we're back live in Alexandria, Louisiana, the home of the Eagles, the Eagles Nest, and a huge play in this football game could be a candidate for cool play of the game. I mean, we've got several to choose from. In fact, we got to be thinking about that. So who's doing the post-game interview? Andrew, you're going to be leaving us here in a minute. Man, what a game. I haven't even thought about it. Our cool play of the game, we'll have the name, and then we'll have a Quibido's player of the game. We'll need to make sure you text us. You know, and see who it is. And that way we get a picture of them. So you'll see if you tune into the Coach Speak show Sunday night at 5, we'll have all of the Quibido's player of the games.
Number 2 Johnson, on the top there.
Johnson under center, 4th and 4, and they're going to fake the pitch, roll it out. Drake Aldridge is chasing him. He's going to throw the ball.
Good play.
It's
batted
knocked
away.
Down by Drake Aldridge. And the Eagles hold on fourth and four. Drake Aldridge held the edge and blocked the ball. That is a candidate for Southern Air's cool play of the game. As it Eagles hold. And a turnover on downs. And the Eagles will take over at their own 43.
Tell you, great play. Drake wasn't fooled. He came back reverse field and was coming out looking for his receiver downfield. And Drake got the angle on him and said, wasn't going to outrun me this time. And he didn't let him get outside and went to throw the ball. Drake got the big paws up and got it batted down.
Now it's the offense's turn. They just need to run the clock out. Get a couple of first downs. Of course, Oakdale just used a timeout. That's also big. They only have two timeouts.
I think we're hitting a time. We're having to get a timeout because we couldn't get our formation out, or our play called huddle in time. So we're going to burn a timeout right here. But the clock wasn't running.
No, it doesn't. You know, that was a little bit of a hurt because the clock wasn't running. But
It was a change of possession, so the clock doesn't run. So I mean, us taking this timeout doesn't really hurt anything, and let the offense understand what they need to do here. And you know, Oakdale's going to make it tougher. They know we're going to try to run the ball at them, so they're going to bring guys in the box and come after us pretty hard on the run stop.
This is where they can be burned deep. You know, if they fake the handoff, and now you got Gavin who's throwing the ball too. You know, he's got a couple of completions tonight. You know, so if you try to get somebody behind him when they start to run the ball. You know that Tim Tebow play?
I know they do it at
the goal line.
Yeah, yeah. You don't want to run.
You don't want to jump and fake, but that kind of step forward and back it out.
You know, look, at the start of the game, we thought Oakdale's secondary might be biting early and playing a little undisciplined. They've actually played pretty well. Their secondary played really well in the first half. So, you know, depending on what they're thinking here, it may be an opportunity. But your number one priority here is try to churn that clock.
And no penalties. The Eagles, I think this is the most penalized game the Eagles have had. They've been very, very disciplined on the line and everywhere, but a lot of penalties. Gavin Hilton with a big run. Breaking tackles! And he picked up the first down inside Oakdale territory at the Oakdale 46-yard line. Big run. And Oakdale getting up a little tired now. They've been hammered by this line. The offensive line has played really hard. 52 doesn't want any more. He wants out. Yeah.
So, you know, we'll be able to snap this ball with almost 4 minutes to go in this fourth quarter and try to work on some clock here. One thing you don't want to do as an offense, and we've had some false starts, you don't want to get that offensive line in their positions too long.
Right.
You know, you get that those big offensive linemen down in their three-point stance and – you got to hold them there for 10, 15 seconds. That can hurt you sometimes. So I like what they're doing. They're breaking the huddle with about 12 seconds to go. The line will get down with about 7 or so seconds, so they don't have to hold them that long in their stance.
So the Eagles in the Wild Eagle with Gavin. They're probably just going to ride Gavin the rest of the way. He's going to follow Cooper Scott, and they drop him Maybe picked up a yard? Man, oh, man, he was able to squeeze in there and get a yard. Down to the 45-yard line, 3:54 and counting. They can run this clock down to about 3:20.
Yeah, 3:15, 3:20 after this play, and then I got a feeling you'll probably start seeing some Oakdale timeouts.
That's good news. Hunter Vaughn, number 82, we saw him limp off on that two-point conversion. He was on the receiving end and got hammered at the knee, and he was going forward and his leg was going backwards. But he does have 3 offsides penalties, so he's going to have to stay put when he gets up there. They're under 10 seconds. They've been running the clock down perfect. Now they just got to hold their spot and take the snap. Cooper Scott's going to go up the middle. He's bulling his way up inside the 40.
Close.
That should be first down territory. They're going to say third. They're going to say he's just short. He had to get to about the 36. He gets this first down. It's going to be third and less than a yard. Well, they're going to call it exactly a yard. Oakdale's going to have to use a timeout if they get this first down. They're going to be able to run this all the way down to about 212.
Yeah.
215. Surprised they're not using a timeout now.
Well, I am too, but, you know, I guess they're going to see what they can do here. I think if we make the first down here, you know, Oakdale still only has two left. We could get that clock well under a minute, even if we don't get the next first down.
Eagles lead at 13-12, looking for a district championship outright for the first time in over a decade. Snap is high. Cooper Scott picks it up, and he's going to be taken down at the 40, and that's going to be a loss of three yards. As a snap, it was a little bit high, but he just took his eyes off of it.
Yeah, a little high snap. He was lucky to get that one back. Almost disaster.
Now we've got a fourth down, 30 seconds. We'll carry this one down to about 140, 130, almost 130, a minute and 30 seconds left. They're going to let this run down. I would say run it all the way down to 1 second and call a timeout.
Yeah, that's what it looks like. Coach Perkins walking over to the line judge down here, and he's going to watch that clock and probably get him a timeout with 1 second to go.
Oakdale not saving any time. I think this is very interesting on their clock management over there. 2-1, he better be there and call it. He stayed by the official. I tell you what, we'll take a quick commercial break, and you know what? I got to run that. So I forgot Andrew left us. We'll be back right after these messages.
Wherever you are, you're there for a reason. You shouldn't have to make a trip to the branch to deposit a check. Skip the trip and use our mobile app to easily and securely deposit checks right from your phone. Day or night, wherever you are, or whatever you're doing. Download our mobile app today.
Is your vision just not as crisp and clear as it used to be? Are you having difficulty driving, especially at night? Are you over 40 and now needing reading glasses? If so, the trusted eye care team at Wallace Eye Associates is here to help with your family's eye care needs, just like we have been for nearly 40 years. Call Wallace Eye Associates today at 318-448-4488 to schedule your next eye evaluation.
And we're back live as the Eagles come out on fourth down. We'll see what they dialed up. They started this drive at their own 43-yard line with about over five minutes to go, and they've worn the clock down to 127 and counting.
So we got Matthew Hicks in the game. I'm not sure if we're going to shift into something and do a quick punt or if we're going for it.
Well, Ryan Hicks would be the punter, though.
Yeah, well,
Matt Hicks is running all the way out here. And it is under center. They're going to try and draw them off sides and maybe use another timeout. And that's what they do. So the Eagles try to draw them off sides. Oakdale very disciplined and not moving. And now we'll run Ryan Hicks out and punt it deep. And the defense has to hold for, you know, a minute and 27 seconds. So they make it all the way down to the Oakdale 40. So that is 17 yards of offense. That's going to be.
You know, I thought, you know, with Matthew Hicks, I know he's also a soccer player and decent kicker. I thought maybe they were going to switch into a quick kick formation when Oakdale didn't have anybody deep and try to pin them inside the 20 there with a quick change on the formation.
So Ryan Hicks will be waiting. Do a little update here.
I tell you, I hope, you know, we need a 41-yard punt right here to make sure we get this thing in the end zone so we don't have any threat of a return.
Yeah, Matthew Hicks standing at his 46-yard line. I mean, Ryan Hicks. Matt with a great punt. Ryan's going to run it and run some time and now punt it, waiting for everybody to get down there. We're going to actually catch it. Good. And we haul it in inside the 10. That was caught by 17. That was Matthew Hicks.
Yeah, Matthew Hicks.
He snapped it.
He did.
He, you know, snapped it and got down there.
You got to remember, in high school, you can't hit the long snapper, right? So usually 9 out of 10 times the long snapper is not covered with a guy over the top of him. So typically the long snapper is one of the first guys that can get down there. And Matthew, having a little bit of speed, got down there and pinned him inside the 10.
That was a 30.
Yeah, I think we were on the 40-yard line, so that was a 34-yard kick.
34-yard, 33-yard punt hauled in by Matthew Hicks. And what a game this has been. We got a minute and 20 seconds, and the defense has got to hold.
Yeah, here, you just don't give up the big play, right? I mean, keep everything in front of you. They got two timeouts. We know they're not a field goal threat. Probably going to be throwing this ball, but you know that quarterback's mobile, so it's you know, got to play some good defense right here.
Hey, the ball is on the ground. He's picked it up. He's going to try to throw it. He's back in the end zone. It could be a safety. That's a throwing. Yeah. Boy, he was nailed close at the one. Man, Cooper Scott had a shot to nail him in the end zone for a safety, which would have ended the ball game. But instead, he gets the ball off, and it's incomplete. It'll be second down and 10 from their own 7-yard line. 1:18 on the clock. Everybody on pins and needles. And David Perkins wants to know, has some questions.
Well, the clock was at 1:18. I don't think any time ran off the clock. I think we were at 1:18 after the series change. I don't think they ran the clock at all.
And that play took a little bit of time. It should be at least somewhere around, you know, 1:05, about 13 seconds. That's about the average play. I know, because I cut highlights all the time for the coaches show. About 15 seconds or so, and that's with a little bit of an extension after the tackle, so you're not just cutting it off after the tackle.
Yeah, they brought the clock down to 1:14.
Only 4 seconds?
Well, when you don't run the clock, I mean, it's kind of hard to say what ran off, and typically your line judge is supposed to be keeping time here. And
obviously wasn't.
Yeah.
So they took a guess. Now what are they doing?
Well, I think he's got to explain to the Oakdale coach why they took 4 seconds off the clock, because he's probably wondering, why'd you take 4 seconds off my clock?
Well, you know what? He should kind of chill out, because he's lucky it's not more than that. I mean, heck, the ball was short. Quarterback had to scoop it up, ran to the edge, was almost tackled, broke out of it in the end zone, and then was hit trying to throw from about the one. I think that's, for Oakdale, that's a blessing to only run 4 seconds off the clock. Here we go, second down and 10 for Oakdale. Menard tried to get the stop. They're going to try to throw it. They got pressure. Some pressure in the end zone. He's going to try. He always passed the.
Oh, intercept. Ah, oh, dropped it. Gavin almost had it off the deflection, and it hit the ground and had two shots at it, but still good coverage by the secondary there.
Oh, that's right. He was not past the line of scrimmage when he threw it.
Yeah, line of scrimmage was a 7. He was behind the 5 when he let that go. But good plays by the defensive secondary on the coverage there, and almost had the interception to seal it.
9 seconds ran off on that play. 1:05 on the play clock. I mean, the game clock. That's 1:05 left in this ball game. Eagles holding on to a 1-point lead, and there is not any movement from the fans in this one. They are, well, there's a couple of people walking, but not many. They're still here, though. Here's the snap. He's in the end zone looking to throw. He's got it over the middle, and that was batted down. Batted down by Cooper Scott in the end zone. That's going to set up 4th and 10 with a minute left, and they got to go for it. And the Eagles will have it. If they can stop them shy or just stop the play altogether, they'll have it at the 7-yard line. One play, but they got to stop. They cannot give them the 10 yards. If Eagles hold anything shy of 10 yards, they will have victory formation and be district champs outright on homecoming night.
And this is where your, you know, defensive lineman, you pin your ears back and go after him. But he's going to be running, so.
Cooper Scott's probably going to be blitzing in there too. But
I would think so.
He got trying to get in the middle. Hung up, but they're stretching him out. Got to run him up.
He's going to run it.
Now he's past the line of scrimmage. He's going to be tackled. Eagles stop him at the 13, 14-yard line. That's going to be shy, and the Eagle defense holds. They shut the Oakdale Warriors out in the second half. Gave up 12 in the first half and allowed no points in the second half. They have a 13-12 lead, 52 seconds left, and the Eagles can kneel this one out and win the district championship in David Perkins' first year as head coach. They will move to 6-3 on the year.
what a fitting way to seal the win for the district championship, right? Got the defense on the field, got them backed up inside their 10-yard line and need four good stops, and you pick them up. And they got 0 yards until that last play, and he was pressed out of the pocket with the rush and couldn't do anything. And good pursuit by Menard.
Plus seven. So look at this. They had 230 yards of offense in the first half, 35 yards of offense in the second half. Tell me that that wasn't, you know, adjustments made by the defense.
Well, and the offense. I mean, you could see there were some adjustments made on the offense and what they were doing a little bit with their blocking schemes and what they did up front and able to get actually on the outside of Oakdale, you know, in the second half with Gavin and the speed. So doing a good job, and they'll nail it here. And I'm sure Oakdale fans.
There they
and
go, David.
Are,
David knows it now. He's got 26 seconds on the game clock, 38 seconds on the play clock. They don't have to run another one. And the Eagles are your District 4 2A state champs all by themselves with a 4-0 record. They move to 6-3 on the year, and they move Oakdale to 6-3 and hand them their third loss here at home. They get revenge for last year's game. And they've done that quite a bit this year with most of their opponents. And the Eagles, what a turnaround. They had 54 yards of offense and were shut out in the first half. They get 119 yards of offense in the second half and two touchdowns. And that one extra point by Ryan Hicks, that first touchdown, was all they needed because the two-point conversion failed. But they win it by one, 13-12. And what a great job by the by this Eagle defense, because I said it on Wednesday night, the Oakdale Warriors were averaging almost like 50 points a game all season long, and the Eagles were averaging about 18 points a game all year long.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, Oakdale, I mean, you look at them, they're big, they're physical, they're fast, right? Yeah, they do play undisciplined football, but that first half that Oakdale played, they played very disciplined football. And, you know, gave our offense fits. But I tell you what, the coaches made great adjustments in the second half. Offense got rolling in that third quarter. And what a tale of two halves here. And I'm sure those – and I can see the Oakdale coaches are literally got their hats off, scratching their heads, probably wondering what happened in the second half here. And I tell you what, Menard played like Menard's played the last couple of games in the second half and got physical, and that was the difference in this ball game.
Yep, and so the game is over. The Eagles are on homecoming, district champs outright. This senior team and this whole team has turned this program around. It has been a long time coming for the Eagles to win a district championship and to do it outright, and they did it with a big crowd and even former coach Freddie Hallman in the crowd tonight as I am trying to find Andrew to get him on the phone. We're going to have one excited coach tonight. While I'm doing that, John, why don't you give everybody the Southern Air cool play of the game tonight?
Yeah, so I think, you know, you look at that Oakdale series where they had the ball kind of at midfield there in the fourth quarter, and big number 81 on fourth down, got a pass rush and quarterback kind of coming back around to the other side of the field, looking downfield, and Drake Aldridge gets out there and says, no, sir, you're not going to outrun me today to the edge, and gets his paw up and gets that pass batted down on fourth down to give Menard, pretty much seals it at that point for Menard.
And we had a great job on defense. Drake Aldridge chasing down the quarterback and knocking the ball down to have a turnover on downs. Lolly Dude, great call tonight for the PA announcing up here. And thanks for all the plugs for 446 Sports, Wildwood Pizza Night, Eagles Nest Coaches Show. Should have a huge crowd Wednesday night at Wildwood for the Coaches Show. And then, of course, we're back home next week against Glen Oaks. And I know we got Richard or Andrew on the phone, but I don't know. We don't have coach yet.
Yeah, and, you know, the weather's going to be great Wednesday, right? It's going to feel like football weather. And you know what? It's going to feel like playoff football weather. And that's where the Eagles are heading here in a couple of weeks.
And well, and speaking of that, look, they're holding a trophy over there. I don't know if they play for a trophy. We'll have to ask coach about it, but they're holding something up. But I don't know if Oakdale and Menard play for something. Interesting, but great crowd tonight on both sides of the field. You can see David right there talking to his team, and all the fans are out there.
Yeah, I was about to say, you probably got a lot of parents out there, a lot of senior parents out there. You know, it's been a long time since Menard's had the outright district championship.
What a job. I know his family watches on 446 Sports. Thanks to everybody who tunes in to watch us. Hope you enjoyed this one. We're not going to end it here yet. I'm debating on whether to take a commercial or not, but I think what I'm going to do is just say thank you to Polos and Plaids located on Metro Drive. Michelle LaCour doing, you know, all kind of plaid uniforms for the Catholic schools. If you need anything in plaid or you need fishing shirts or any kind of dance line stuff, sparkly stuff, what do you call it, John?
Glitter.
Glitter.
Or glitter. 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 That's a glitter dress is what I was informed.
A glitter dress. So all that kind of stuff. She really has found her niche with all that. So go check her out. Check out Insight Audio, Video, and Security. They are responsible for all of our home away games and the Wildwood Coaches Show, Eagles Nest Coaches Show, with a hotspot. They've done it last year. And this year, Adam Rhodes has been so great with helping us out with that. And anytime we need that hotspot, he has allowed us to use it. So use them. If an M&M Sound for their speaker. We've got Wildwood Pizza. Go out there and get a great roasted chicken salad. They have other salads too. That's my favorite. And then I like the Hawaiian pizza, but they got all kinds of pizzas out there. David's still talking. Look at Coach Morgan Redmond, and he's talking to all the fans and everything. I think he's as animated now as he was when he got the job and the announcement that we went live on Facebook with. But what a turnaround for this football team. You know, he kept the coaching staff all local, you know, in terms of being Eagle teachers as well as coaches. And all of them have done just a wonderful job. And they are district champions outright with a 4-0 record, undefeated district champs. And Andrew's looking out at the crowd. Jeffrey's going to find Andrew and follow him so that Coach can see him. And Andrew, I know you're listening. See where Coach David is, if I can find him. I'm sure he's getting congratulated like crazy. Just kind of hold your ground there a little bit. Do you see him? Anybody spot him, John?
Yeah, I'm looking for him. I can't find him.
Let's see. Got Coach. So, anyway, 13-12, your final tonight. Andrew, he's probably going to be over on your left a little bit as he's looking. Tell you what, we'll take a quick commercial break, and as soon as Andrew has him, we'll bring it back.
BK Distributors is proud to support high school athletics on 446 Sports. BK is the one-stop shop for trophies, banners, awards, letter jackets, and just about anything award-related. And now, welcome BK Apparel BK Promotions to the family.
For all your spirit apparel needs
and anything you need to brand your business. When you think of anything you need with your name on it, think BK. Check them out on Facebook or at bkdistrib.com. BK Distributors, apparel and promotions in Pineville.
Andrew's got a bead on him. Let's bring it back out to the main camera. See, this is the difference. We go the whole game with Andrew producing, and I don't have to worry about a thing. And then Andrew gets to do the post-game interview with David Perkins, head coach David Perkins, and I'm trying to produce, and we're going to black. We got all kinds of issues happening. Let's see. Did you get eyes on him?
I see him right now. He's taking pictures.
Okay. Well, go get him. Go get him, Andrew. He's going to be – yeah, go grab him and be by him so he can talk to you, because everybody's going to want to talk to Coach and see if you can grab him real quick. All right. Andrew's got Coach David Perkins, not just Coach David Perkins, but the District 4-2A champion David Perkins and the Menard Eagles. Congratulations, Coach.
Appreciate that, man. It's big for our Holy Savior Mark community, man. We told these guys at halftime we had them right where we wanted them. We actually said we're going to win 14-12. If I went for the extra point, we might have won 14-12. But, man, what a great comeback. Defense played awesome as usual. Offense played good enough to get the points on the board, man. I couldn't be more proud of this team.
Yeah, what about the crowd, David, tonight? I mean, they were in it the whole time. You guys kept them in the game and kept them here the whole time.
Well, I mean, that series right before the half where they drove it down and they got close to our end zone right there, man, that was a big stop for us. We went in and said, you know, hey, if we don't get that stop, we probably out of this game. We made the stop. There was a reason we made the stop. We're coming back to win this game, baby, and we did.
Go ahead, Andrew.
All right, I have a question. I saw a trophy being handed out. Is that a trophy for you guys?
That's the 2023 district championship trophy, and I got that this week and just hid it in my closet and just hoped we would win tonight, and I was able to present it. What a great victory.
Man,
that's great.
That's awesome, David. And you know, you talked about it. And then the defense, look, it was a tale of two halves. You know, it was 12-0 at the half, and then the defense shut out Oakdale after Oakdale had those two big 68-yard runs for touchdowns.
Yeah, you know, two plays right there. You know, we get those two plays back, we're gonna pitch another shutout. But, you know, like we told the guys, Oakdale's trying to win too. They got good coaches. They had a good team. You know, they got away from us. You know, we were just able to fight our way back and get the victory, baby.
You know, offensively, I don't think they were ready. I mean, tip your hat off to the offensive line and the defense. But Gavin Hilton, I know Cooper Scott was big again, but Gavin Hilton, he ran like a different player tonight.
He sure did. 12 wanted it. 33 wanted it. We talked to those guys all week, man. And you could tell by the way he was running the ball in the second half, man. He told me. He told me at the half, Coach, we're winning this game. And he took over the offense especially. He plays defense too, but he took over, man, and he was running the ball like a wild man.
Hey, Coach Perkins, this is John Wolf. I noticed in the second half, the offense, you know, we've talked about the offense kind of having struggles throughout the year and getting some points on the board. And, boy, the second half they came out and the physicality they showed compared to what the first half. Just interested, what'd y'all tell them at halftime to get them fired up like that in the second half?
Well, we told these guys that the game was going to be on the offensive line, and it was. And you could see that those guys played very, very tough in the second half. You know, we kind of went to that single wing. You know, we put in an extra lineman, and you put Cooper Scott and number 12 back there and just tell them to find the crease, man, and that's what they did. And we were able to score two touchdowns and get the dub, baby.
Man, yeah. What a turnaround, David. You know, I loved having you in the booth, but, boy, it's been great watching you down there on the field. Congratulations, district champion head coach David Perkins, outright champion, not even sharing it with anybody. This is the only time that you can be selfish, David.
Absolutely. I told Father today, I was like, Father, I know we're supposed to share, but we're not sharing this district championship with anybody, baby.
All right, baby. Congratulations, David. Thanks for everything. Next week, Glen Oaks right here in the Eagles' Nest. All right, congratulations.
Absolutely.
Go enjoy it, buddy.
Thank you. Go Eagles.
Thanks, Andrew. Make it back here. And I tell you what, we've held it here the whole time. We're going to close out. Just remember all of our sponsors, you know, to our fans that are watching tonight and those that are tuning in, you know, after this game is over, because it is archived on Facebook and YouTube. Just please notice the sponsors in the top right corner, as well as Valex and Sadler's Towing and Wallace Eye Center, and use them when you need any of their services. And we just thank you for being with us all year long and allowing this to happen. All of the Menard sponsors too. John, final words?
Yeah, you know, just great homecoming week, good fitting finish, great ball game, district champs. You know, we got homecoming. Kids are going to be out tomorrow night at dances. So, please, everybody, be safe out there this weekend.
Be safe out there. And one thing that we didn't have at halftime, Andrew and Jeffrey had all of the winners of the King and Queen and all that stuff that they give away. But the float winners were announced in the fourth quarter. Third place went to the 11th grade, second place to the 8th grade, and first place to the 7th grade float, which I thought was the winner. And junior high ruled
floats. They usually do.
All right, so for Jeffrey Owens on camera, did a great job tonight. The pregame interview for Andrew Beeman. For the post-game interview and producing this show. Without you guys, this would have been a different year for Menard football on 446 Sports. For John Wolf, I'm Tom Boucher. You've been watching Menard Eagle Football live broadcast, brought to you by all of our sponsors and our crew here all season long. We're back with the Eagles Nest Coaches Show on Wednesday night at 7, live from Wildwood Pizza. Back here next week at 7 p.m. against Glen Oaks. They will travel from Baton Rouge to be here. I'm Tom Boucher. God bless. Have a wonderful weekend, and we'll see you next week.
Go Tigers.